Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Beautiful Country and the Middle Kingdom, America and China, 1776 to the Present, by John Pomfret. Read by Tom Perkins. Prologue. On a barren subarctic landmass 9,000 miles from his native Boston, William Dane Phelps stalked his prey. A colony of elephant seals lazed on a narrow beach, safe from the sharks and orcas that fed on them in the open sea. But here came Phelps, a teenager with a spear. 10 people were waiting to eat, and Phelps had been commanded to cook. The only problem, the meat, all 1,900 pounds of it, was alive. "I was left alone to get breakfast," Phelps recalled. "I knew nothing of the habits of the elephant, had never seen one killed, and there I was." Phelps picked what looked to be the most docile of the beasts and leapt into battle. He struck the seal on the nose. The animal reared up on its flippers, bellowing as it towered over the boy. That opened up the monster's midsection. Phelps tried to plunge in his spear, but the animal caught the weapon in its mouth and gave it a jerk, cracking Phelps on the head and knocking him on his back. Phelps righted himself, bashed out the creature's eyes with his club, and, he wrote, lanced him until he was dead. It was 1817, and 15-year-old Phelps was a 6-month sail from home, having just landed on Marion Island, a speck of land 1,000 miles from the southernmost tip of Africa. Phelps was one of a crew of 25 aboard the Pickering, a brig from Boston that was scouring the seas for fur seals. They had struck pay dirt on Marion. While their ship went off in search of more treasure, Phelps and 7 others remained on the windswept isle to hunt and skin. Phelps and his shipmates spent almost 2 years on Marion, living in a cave and clothing themselves in animal skins as they killed thousands of fur seals and amassed tons of elephant seal oil. But the men's bounty was not destined for the coats, mufflers, and night lamps of the moneyed families of Beacon Hill and Back Bay. When the Pickering returned for the hunters, it whisked them off not to New England, but to Canton, China. In the early 19th century, the promise of the China market sent Americans journeying around the world, killing and harvesting in staggering numbers. 6 million fur seals, the pelts of 250,000 sea otters, tons of sea cucumber and ginseng, forests of sandalwood, millions of silver dollars, all destined for China. Phelps and hundreds of other Americans spun the first threads of an enormous tapestry that they and their Chinese friends, competitors, customers, lovers, and enemies would weave into a story of wild exploits, extreme misjudgments, and unsung impact. Many Americans believe that their country's ties to China began when Richard Nixon traveled there in 1972, ending the Cold War between the two nations. In fact, the two sides have been interacting with and influencing each other since the founding of the United States. It wasn't just free land that lured American settlers westward. It was also the dream of selling to China. The idea of America also inspired the Chinese, pulling them toward modernity and the outside world. American science, educational theory, and technology flowed into China. Chinese art, food, and philosophy flowed out. Since then, thread by thread, the two peoples and their various governments have crafted the most multifaceted and today the most important relationship between any two nations in the world. Now is the time to retell the story of the United States and China. Today, these two nations face each other, not quite friends, not yet enemies, pursuing parallel quests for power while the world watches. No problem of worldwide concern, from global warming to terrorism to the proliferation of nuclear weapons to the economy, can be solved unless Washington and Beijing find a way to work together. America's first fortunes were made in the China trade from 1783 until the early 1800s, and profits from that commerce bankrolled America's Industrial Revolution. In the 1830s, the 40-odd Americans living in the tiny trade outpost on the outskirts of Canton boxed far above their weight. Thanks to their labors, the United States became the Middle Kingdom's number two trading partner after the mighty British. Chinese officials then began what would become a tradition, looking at the United States as a bulwark against China's enemies. Over the years, they would propose alliances with the United States to counter the British, the Germans, the Russians or Soviets, and the Japanese. The first American Christian missionaries arrived in China in the 1830s. Though they are often held up as an unbecoming example of American cultural imperialism, forcing Jesus on an unwilling people steeped in an older Confucian creed, they were crucial to China's development. Along with Western-educated Chinese, they supplied the tools to break the stranglehold of traditional orthodoxy. They taught the Chinese Western science, critical thinking, sports, industry, and law. They established China's first universities and hospitals. These institutions, though now renamed, are still the best of their kind in China. America's women missionaries crusaded against the barbaric customs of female infanticide and foot binding, helping to accomplish the greatest human rights advances in modern Chinese history. As Americans brought Christianity to China, laborers from southern China flocked to California in search of gold. By the 1860s, they constituted the largest population of foreign-born people in the American West. Those who didn't pan for gold wound up building the West. They drained the Sacramento River Delta, creating one of the richest agricultural belts in history. They laid half of the transcontinental railroad connecting the East and West coasts. With their grocery stores, laundries, vegetable patches, and apothecaries stocked with herbal remedies, they provided essential services without which the West could not have been won. Mainstream Americans turned on the Chinese in the 1870s. Congress made them the first ethnic group to be banned from the United States when it blocked Chinese workers from America in 1882. The Chinese did not stop coming, however, and using funds collected by Chinese merchants, they hired America's best lawyers to challenge a raft of racist laws and ordinances. Those cases contributed greatly to the advancement of civil rights for all Americans, undergirding, for example, the push in the 1950s to dismantle the separate but equal educational system for American blacks. Despite its racism, America remained a land where many Chinese could realize their dreams. The Chinese were hounded across the West, not simply because they were different. In their industriousness, they rivaled and threatened competing white settlers, and they made whites work harder. That ability to thrive in America and make all of America more competitive continues to this day. While some Americans hated the Chinese, others nurtured a deep concern with China's well-being. Though commercial activity dominated the U.S. approach to Europe, South America, Japan, and elsewhere, the emotional attachment to these places, with the exception of Great Britain, was not nearly so deep as that to China. "Clear your plate, there are children starving in China," was a dinner table mantra for generations of Americans. So was the Pennies for China campaign in churches across the heartland. With the turn of the 20th century and the dawning of America as a global power, policymakers in Washington took more interest in China and fought to keep the country whole, despite efforts by European nations and Japan to carve it into colonies. American statesmen moved to bind China's best and brightest to the United States, establishing a fund to educate Chinese stateside. The Boxer Indemnity Scholarship spawned Nobel Prize winners, scientists, politicians, engineers, and writers, and set the scene for a Chinese intellectual renaissance in the 1920s and 1930s. Those same decades found Americans intrigued by Chinese culture, its food, art, poetry, and mysticism. A Chinese-American woman from Los Angeles became the first non-white movie star in the United States. American taste buds accepted Chinese food. American tycoons put together the world's greatest collections of Chinese art and endowed museums from Boston to New York, Washington, Kansas City, and San Francisco to house them. In 1937, the Japanese invasion of China knit China and America closer together than ever. Before the war, there had been 10,000 Americans in China. Their numbers jumped tenfold in just a few years. But as the war progressed, America came to see its Chinese ally, Generalissimo Chiang Kai-shek, as dictatorial, incompetent, and, worst of all, unwilling to fight Japan. As a result, many Americans viewed Chiang's enemies, the Chinese Communist Party, as the true guerrilla David battling a mechanized Japanese Goliath. State Department officials were convinced of the accuracy of this perspective and steered U.S. policy away from providing aid to Chiang for his showdown with the Communists after the war. We now know that the reality was more complex. Chiang's armies fought so stalwartly that it was they, not the Communists, who sustained 90% of the casualties battling the Japanese. Americans at the time comforted themselves with the notion that the United States had done all it could to help Chiang Kai-shek, but countless promises of aid, weapons, and gold to his government had gone unfulfilled. Some historians have argued that after the war, the United States missed a chance to forge good relations with Chairman Mao Zedong as communism took hold. But documents from Chinese archives released in recent years show that Mao was not ready for ties with America. Mao used hatred of the U.S. as an ideological pillar of his revolution. Even today, the legacy of Mao's paranoia about America colors China's relationships with the United States. In the 1970s, Western obituaries reporting the demise of American influence in China were premature. Almost from the day China reopened to the West, American pragmatism, its free market approach, and light-touch regulation have dominated China's economic reforms. American culture has monopolized its movie and TV screens, and Christianity, despite communist oppression, has experienced a renaissance of unprecedented proportions. American values, education, and even its fresh air are the envy of many Chinese. From Deng Xiaoping on, every communist leader has sent at least one of his children to the U.S. to study, including the Harvard-educated daughter of the current president, Xi Jinping. When the two nations rediscovered each other in the 1970s, American sympathetic regard for the Middle Kingdom was rekindled, and Americans again worked to make China strong. Since then, no other country has been more important to China's rise than the United States. Its open markets, open universities, and open society have served as the key foreign drivers of China's return to greatness. Meanwhile, China has renewed its claim on the American imagination and entered every home with the ubiquitous three-word phrase, "Made in China." For those listening to this book in China, the time is also right for a reappraisal of the Middle Kingdom's ties to Meiguo, the beautiful country, China's name for the United States. Communist histories have twisted the story of America's 200-year-long association with China. In the early days of the relationship, Chinese are told, the United States schemed to colonize China, acting no better than the imperialist powers of old Europe or even Japan. They're taught that American charity was a trick. The Chinese version of World War II airbrushes American sacrifices from the tale. China, not the United States, beat Japan, the Chinese learn. As for the Korean War, to this day, Chinese textbooks maintain that South Korea, backed by America, started that conflagration, when in truth, it was the North Koreans supported by Joseph Stalin and Mao. Over the past 5 decades, these same textbooks also claim America has sought to keep China down. Still, although the Communist Party won't admit it publicly, many Chinese privately acknowledge America's role in China's ascent and the fact that, more than perhaps any other nation, China has benefited from the Pax Americana, the system of free trade, secure waterways, and globalized financial markets built by the United States and its allies after World War II. It is no coincidence that although China's growth was impressive in the 1980s and 1990s, it became a global trading power only after 2001, when the United States ushered it into the World Trade Organization. As the imprisoned Nobel Peace Prize laureate Liu Xiaobo observed, China needs challenge, even menace from another civilization. It needs a vast and surging boundless sea to pound it out of its isolation, its solitude, and its narrow-mindedness. America has filled that role. Year by year, decade by decade, the two nations have bound themselves closer together. America has been China's top trading partner since the 1990s. China surpassed Canada to become America's top partner in 2015. Scientists on both sides of the Pacific cooperate in more fields, fighting cancer, splitting genes, looking for clean energy, investigating atomic particles, discovering new drugs, than their counterparts in any other two countries. Complications between these two great nations abound as the United States and China and Americans and Chinese cooperate and compete across the world. If there is a pattern to this baffling complexity, it may be best described as a never-ending Buddhist cycle of reincarnation. Both sides experience rapturous enchantment begetting hope, followed by disappointment, repulsion, and disgust, only to return to fascination once again. In the 19th and 20th centuries, American missionaries fantasized that China would become the world's largest Christian nation, while mandarins in Beijing counted on America to shield their country from the depredations of European imperialists and Japan. Neither wish was fulfilled. But new expectations follow inevitable disillusion with every spin of history's wheel. At present, Americans have entered the disenchantment phase of the cycle, their views clouded by economic and strategic concerns. China, the narrative goes, pilfers American jobs, swipes its secrets, stockpiles its debt, and is now scheming to expel the U.S. Navy from the Western Pacific. In the American imagination, China has traversed the arc from object of benevolence to fount of anxiety. A trip to the Great Wall, the Forbidden City, and the tomb of the first emperor once topped the bucket list of generations of Americans. Today, U.S. tourist visits to China are flat, and public opinion toward the country has soured. The Chinese feel dispirited, too. Their leaders expected America to make way for China in the Pacific. In the 1970s, senior American officials assured them that the U.S. would pull its troops from South Korea and step aside as China recovered Taiwan, thereby completing China's unification. Many Chinese have also grown tired of Americans telling them what to do. At the same time, other Chinese understand that they are losing the goodwill of many Americans, and this has given them pause. While Americans are asking whether they have given China too much, some Chinese are beginning to ask whether they have pushed America too far. These fluctuations, too, are rooted in history. The two nations have feuded fiercely and frequently, yet irresistibly and inevitably, they are drawn back to one another. The result is two powers locked in an entangling embrace that neither can quit. William Dane Phelps would graduate from deckhand to captain and make a handsome living killing sea mammals and selling their hides and oil to the Chinese. Generations of Americans and Chinese followed in his wake, weaving together two vastly different cultures. Through all the whipsaw cycles of boom and bust, dashed hopes and exalted dreams, rivers of blood and mountains of trade, the relationship between the United States and China is powered by love and hate, contempt and respect, fear and awe, generosity and greed. Chinese and Americans arouse deeply conflicted feelings in one another, yet no other two nations' mutual dependence is as vital to the fate of the world as the one between these two great powers. In search of wiser choices for the future, we look to a story that began three centuries ago in the founding of a young nation and the death knell of an old one. Part 1. Chapter 1. A New Frontier. The year was 1776, and the American colonies were seized with revolutionary fervor. But in New Hampshire, a 25-year-old student studying to be a missionary dropped out of Dartmouth College and shipped out with the Royal Navy on Captain James Cook's third and final voyage. 6 years later, after Cook was killed in Hawaii, the sailor, John Ledyard, returned to America's shores to proselytize not for God, but for trade with China. John Ledyard was fired up by a scheme to dispatch Yankee ships around the tip of South America to the Pacific Northwest to collect the pelts of the Northwest sea otter for the China market. Coastal Indians would barter a pelt for only a hatchet or a saw, Ledyard wrote. But the Chinese would pay 100 Mexican silver dollars for a single fur, a markup that his contemporary Adam Smith could love. A Connecticut Yankee with a hooked nose, an ample inheritance, and a penchant for trouble, Ledyard was an American visionary in a time of global turmoil. The Spanish and Portuguese empires were crumbling, the Royal Navy ruled the seas, and America's War of Independence had left the United States barely united and deeply in debt. Britain had shut Yankee merchants out of the lucrative trade with the British West Indies. America's once-thriving shipping industry limped along. Its whaling and cod businesses were in tatters. Its slave trade fared little better. "The town of Boston is really poor," complained the Reverend John Eliot in a letter to a friend in March 1780. "If some brighter prospects do not open up, it is my opinion that we cannot subsist." Americans needed a new frontier beyond Europe's sway, and it was to China that they turned, planting deep within the Yankee imagination the fancy that China's markets held the answer to American prayers. In May 1783, Ledyard chased down Robert Morris, the Philadelphia merchant and signer of the Declaration of Independence who had bankrolled the American Revolution. After sharing his China plan with Morris, Ledyard boasted that he would soon be at the helm of the greatest commercial enterprise that has ever been embarked on in this country. But Morris and his partners dawdled, and the impatient Ledyard left the United States again. Urged on by Thomas Jefferson, he tried to cross Russia's vast expanse to reach America's west coast, but the Russians stopped him. His next venture led him to Africa, but as he began his journey into the continent in January 1789, he accidentally poisoned himself and died. Robert Morris stuck with the China idea, however, and on a wintry Sunday, February 22, 1784, the Empress of China, a three-masted ship of 360 tons, set sail from New York Harbor bound for the prosperous southern Chinese port of Guangzhou, known to Westerners as Canton. The Empress carried a crew of 42, a box of beaver skins, 12 casks of spirits, and 20,000 Mexican silver dollars. But her prize cargo was 30 tons of American ginseng harvested in the Appalachian forests. Philip Freneau, the poet of the American Revolution, celebrated the ship's departure with verse reflecting America's newly won liberation. The Empress was heading, he wrote, where George, the British king, forbade Americans to sail before. At noon on May 11, 1785, the Empress returned to New York to a 13-gun salute, one for each of the United States. In her hold, she carried more than 25,000 pounds of tea, a load of cloth, and a large selection of porcelain. The venture earned a 30% profit of more than $30,000, nearly $1 million today. The New York News-Dispatch declared that the journey presages a future happy period of trade with China, an example of the high bar that America's fledgling media were already setting for relations with the Middle Kingdom. Morris backed a second voyage, the Pallas, which made $50,000, but his luck soon soured. Pouring his earnings into a Pennsylvania land deal that went belly up, he was tossed into a debtor's prison. Nonetheless, in the next 15 years, more than 200 American ships would follow the Empress to Guangzhou, a fleet second only to the 400 vessels of the British. Tea, which predated coffee as the American beverage of choice, brought American traders to China. The tea that was tossed into Boston Harbor on the night of December 16, 1773, had been shipped out of the southern Chinese city of Xiamen. Within a few years of independence, tea composed 9/10 of the goods leaving China on American ships. In 1785, American vessels carried less than 1 million pounds of tea from China. In 1840, they moved 19 million. What began as an exchange of American raw materials for Chinese tea soon mushroomed as Asian handicrafts of every variety flooded into the United States. Though today we speak of an American pivot to Asia, American tastes have been pivoting to Asia for more than 200 years. The American appetite for blue and white Chinese bowls, plates, and teacups was so prodigious that New England carracks limped into Boston Harbor with crates suspended over their sides. To a people who only recently had measured wealth by the number of chairs a household owned, Chinese porcelain, known as China, represented status and taste. China in 1800 was a manufacturing powerhouse responsible for about 1/3 of all the goods made in the world, and Americans were beguiled by its products. Willow pattern porcelain, inscribed with trees, bridges, and pagodas, monks and scholars, filled us with wonder and delight, or haunted us in dreams at night, wrote poet Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. Boston's upper crust clothed themselves in Chinese silk. The dining room in George Washington's Mount Vernon boasted a 302-piece dinner and tea set brought to America by the Empress of China. Chinese porcelain sparked the founding of an American porcelain industry. Curtains from China inspired the American drapery business. As there is today, there was fakery on all sides. Chinese artists churned out some 200 copies of Gilbert Stuart's famed portrait of George Washington. Yankee merchants sold them in Philadelphia until Stuart won a court order in 1802 banning their sale. American woodworkers paired pagodas with Algonquin longhouses on Yankee-made side tables made to look Chinese. In Boston and New York, tea salesmen packaged old Chinese tea in new boxes. The entrepreneurial gumption would only be matched 2 centuries later when Chinese knockoff artists produced vast quantities of bogus North Face jackets and pirated DVDs. American fascination with things Chinese went beyond household goods and luxury items. In 1834, 2 New York businessmen brought a Chinese woman named Afong Moy to the city, where they displayed her in a cage. Dressed in Oriental finery, Moy was part of an exhibition to sell Chinese knickknacks. The New York press went wild, extolling her bound feet and exotic ways. When she arrived in New York Harbor in October, the advertised price to see her was a quarter. By the time she opened at 8 Park Place a few weeks later, it was up to 50 cents. Moy's success inspired American showman P.T. Barnum to devote a whole museum to the Chinese, as freaks. Among his showpieces was a pair of conjoined twins. Fused at their rib cages, Chung and Ung Bunker were shipped to the United States in 1829 by Robert Hunter, a British merchant, who believed that he'd struck it rich with a touring exhibition of Chinese mutants. Though they were ethnic Chinese, the pair hailed from Siam, hence the term Siamese twins. After 3 years in America, Chung and Ung successfully sued Hunter for breach of contract and set out on their own. Chung and Ung's case was not the first time Chinese had turned to America's courts for justice. That tradition dates back at least to 1805, when Chinese merchants began filing motions against their deadbeat American counterparts in Philadelphia's courts. Even then, Chinese plaintiffs were impressed with what one petitioner called America's equal protection of the rich and of the poor, and for dealing equal measure to its own citizen and to the alien. Many more cases would follow. Acting as their own managers, Chung and Ung toured the young nation, appearing in formal wear, performing backflips and somersaults, and hoisting portly spectators on their heads. With their earnings, the twins purchased a 100-acre plantation with slaves in Wilkesboro, North Carolina. They married sisters, Sarah and Adelaide Yates, and fathered 21 children. They died in 1874, within 3 hours of one another at the age of 63, and were buried together near their plantation. Although American impresarios promoted Chung and Ung as a gruesome curiosity, their success underlined the opportunities America presented to the Chinese. The pair burrowed deep in the American psyche, resurfacing in a historical novel published in 2000, and again as the characters Terry and Terry Perry in the 2013 animated movie Monsters University. This trade in goods and people reignited America's shipbuilding industry and rekindled its economy. Less than a decade after Reverend Elliot penned Boston's obituary, its shipyards were booming again. In 1789, the Massachusetts, at 900 tons, then the largest ship ever built in the United States, was launched for the China trade. Unfortunately, profit-hungry investors used uncured wood and had the ship built in haste. By the time it limped into Guangzhou Harbor, it was a rotting hulk and had to be sold for scrap. The fortunes that East Coast merchants amassed in the China trade were vital to the United States' evolution from seafaring nation to factory of the world. The Astors, Greens, Russells, Delanos, Lowe's, and Forbes's plowed the proceeds earned in China into New England textile mills, Philadelphia banks and insurance companies, New York real estate, and railroads that laid the foundations for American power. Taxes on the commerce bolstered the fortunes of the U.S. Treasury. "Our trade to the East Indies flourishes," wrote President George Washington to his old comrade in arms, the Marquis de Lafayette, on June 3, 1790. "The profits to individuals are so considerable as to induce more persons to engage in it continually." The promise of the Chinese market drew Americans to the West Coast, Hawaii, and the South Seas in search of goods to trade with the Celestial Kingdom. From the early 1800s, as the young nation's ambitions expanded, business interests lobbied the federal government to secure deep-water ports on the Pacific coast to serve as launching pads into Asia. One hopeful merchant was the New York real estate mogul and German immigrant John Jacob Astor, whose vision for the Oregon Territory as a springboard for American expansion into the Pacific influenced American presidents and secretaries of state. Astor made his fortune trading fur, first with Native Americans in upstate New York and then via ships plying the waters off the Oregon coast. In 1810, he established the Pacific Fur Trading Company and built a settlement, Fort Astoria, on the Columbia River. The British soon seized Astoria, but other Americans flocked to the coast to collect otter pelts for the Canton trade. A key ally in Astor's struggle to fend off foreign competition was John Quincy Adams, son of President John Adams. First as ambassador to Russia and Great Britain, and then as Secretary of State and President, Adams blocked Russian and British forays into California and the Pacific Northwest, sweeping the coast clear for America's westward heave toward the Far East. He, too, believed in the promise of trade with the Middle Kingdom. Even Midwesterners like Senator Thomas Hart Benton caught China fever. In 1819, Benton argued that Missouri's borders should cross the Missouri River Valley to bring the new state just a little closer to China. Contemporary writers imagined an endless wagon train from Ohio to Oregon, lined with densely populated trading posts grown rich on Asian commerce. Despite the fact that trade with China would sputter and slow, in percentage terms it peaked in 1805 to 1808 at about 15% of foreign trade, the sobering reality of the present day never dislodged the oversized expectations for tomorrow. As many do today, Americans then believed that their future resided in Asia. Trade with China also helped cement America's embrace of a rough-and-tumble business model based on individual initiative that became a key to the nation's success. In 1786, Congress rejected a proposal to establish a trading monopoly modeled on Britain's state-run East India Company, which dominated commerce with China. Americans were free traders. Commercial intercourse, Senator Rufus King wrote, then President John Adams, would be more prosperous if left unfettered in the hands of private adventurers. In Asia, these private adventurers faced off against the mightiest trading empire in the world, the United Kingdom, and from the start the Americans dreamed of replacing the Union Jack with the Stars and Stripes as the dominant standard in the Pacific. To compete, the Americans embraced innovation. Their ships were smaller, averaging 350 tons, but cheaper to build and faster than the lumbering 1,200-ton behemoths of the British East India Company. American ships employed fewer men, 19 hands each compared with the 120 crewmen common on British vessels. Sailors on U.S. ships were paid better and encouraged to move up the ranks from deckhand to captain. New Englanders like William Phelps and Amasa Delano, a distant ancestor of Franklin Delano Roosevelt, went to sea as teenagers at a time when it was not unusual for an American captain to be barely 20. They sailed with imprecise navigational instruments. Calculating latitude had been perfected, but longitude would have to wait for later in the century. Lived off maggoty bread and were often racked by venereal disease. But their lodestar was the prospect of profits in Guangzhou, a shining beacon that persuaded America's best and brightest to choose the sea as a career. As William Phelps testifies at the start of his memoir, "Born within a cable's length of the sea-beat shore, inhaling with my earliest breath the atmosphere of the old ocean, it was not matter of much wonder that I was early manifested a strong love for the sea and took to the water as naturally as a duck." After months on board, braving storms and scurvy, the Americans would arrive at the coast of China. The first stop was Macau, a spit of land jutting into the South China Sea, 80 miles down the Pearl River from Guangzhou. Though Macau belonged to China, Chinese authorities had allowed the Portuguese to manage it since the mid-16th century as a way of keeping foreigners out of China proper but close enough to trade. There, American sailors found a melting pot of Pacific Islanders, Filipinos, Malays, Africans, Indians, Europeans, merchants, and gamblers, not to mention the Chinese. The climate, Guangdong's winters were mild compared with the bitter cold of the Northeast, delighted the Yankee sailors. After securing a Chinese boatman, ships would stop at Whampoa, 12 miles from Guangzhou, where traders discharged their cargoes and paid duties. From there, they would head to Guangzhou itself. At various points, the Americans doled out bribes, known as kumshaw or squeeze, to keep the goods moving. Traveling up the Pearl River, the sailors confronted a world afloat. Coastal junks, sampans, ferry boats, barber boats, and food vendors bobbed along in the muddy waters of the Pearl. "We passed a pagoda of large size, 7 stories high," wrote Charles Ting, who sailed from Boston in 1815 at the age of 14. "The houses were curious, similar in appearance as those seen on China plates and other ware. The country seemed crowded with inhabitants, young and old, all moving about like ants round an anthill." To America's founders, China was a source of inspiration. They saw it as a harmonious society with officials chosen on merit, where the arts and philosophy flourished and the peasantry labored happily on the land. Benjamin Franklin venerated China's prison system and sought information on its census, its silk industry, and how its people heated their homes. George Washington wrote that he had once thought that the Chinese, though droll in shape and appearance, were yet white. The American construction of an Asian racial type would happen later in the 19th century. The revolutionary pamphleteer Thomas Paine compared Confucius to Jesus Christ. James Madison and Thomas Jefferson admired China's ability to close itself off from the outside world, finding virtue in its isolation. The Americans who actually went to China, by contrast, were befuddled and awed by the empire. Guangzhou, home to 1 million people, a quarter of the population of the entire United States in 1800, was the greatest city most of them would ever see. Samuel Shaw, a former artillery officer in the Continental Army who traveled to Guangzhou three times before dying of a fever on a return voyage in 1794, remarked on the excellence of the government, but pronounced himself glad to be an American. Amasa Delano described China with the wonder of a country hayseed, contending that it is the first for greatness, riches, and grandeur of any country ever known. Still, he too was distressed when he saw what appeared to be the corpses of mixed-blood babies floating down the Pearl River. Under rules established in the 18th century, trade with China was conducted at arm's length. In theory, Westerners could do business only with a special guild of merchants, commonly known as the 13 Hongs, which was appointed and taxed heavily by the Qing court. Westerners were confined to a compound of about a dozen buildings, called factories, cut off from the general population in a section of Guangzhou outside the city walls and small enough to be measured in footsteps, 270 along the bustling Pearl River and 50 from the riverbank inland. By the mid-1820s, the Americans occupied their own factory on Old China Street. Westerners in Guangzhou were governed by what were known as the Eight Regulations, a long list of rules designed to maintain China's political and national security and manage foreign trade. Among these was a ban on Western women, issued in order to prevent families from settling in China. Another outlawed teaching a foreigner Chinese. To communicate, Chinese and Westerners developed their own language, a melange of English, Portuguese, Dutch, French, and Cantonese that was called Pidgin, derived from the Cantonese pronunciation of the word business. Selling Chinese books to a foreigner was also prohibited, as was spreading Christianity. The Americans soon learned, however, that though the government was wary of foreigners, the Chinese people were less so. Western women may have been forbidden, but British and American captains occasionally sneaked them in from Macau for a look around. Westerners were theoretically allowed to leave the foreign ghetto only when accompanied by a linguist who worked for the government. But as American trader William C. Hunter noted, "We walked when we pleased and remained as long as we pleased, while on each occasion a linguist was the last person we ever saw." Other rules barred foreigners from owning property or conducting business other than trade in Guangzhou. Nonetheless, Americans ran inns and taverns and even, in the case of former slave trader William F. McGee from Rhode Island, hired themselves out as building contractors. Westerners were prohibited from consorting with Chinese women, but William Hunter kept a Chinese lover. Benjamin Chu Wilcox, a Philadelphia merchant and famed gourmand who was the U.S. consul in Guangzhou for a decade, fathered a daughter with his Chinese mistress. In 1833, when he was past 50, Wilcox's mission to find a wife in Philadelphia was almost derailed when his love child arrived aboard a tea ship in the city of brotherly love. Nathan Dunn, a suspect in the first reported sodomy case in Pennsylvania, managed for 8 years to flaunt the Chinese regulation evicting foreigners from Guangzhou after the end of each trading season. It was rumored that he preferred Chinese men. Dunn was also the first American to pursue another passion, Chinese antiquities. On December 22, 1836, he opened a massive exhibition, 10,000 Chinese things, in the new Philadelphia Museum, wowing the cream of American society with an Oriental phantasmagoria. William Hunter's warm feelings for Guangzhou and his Chinese partners were shared by many other American traders who found themselves at sea when they returned to the United States. The banquets, the scenery, the people, the camaraderie with merchants from around the globe, and the unforgettable nature of life in China made America seem dull. Writing of the merchant John P. Cushing, who retired to Boston a multimillionaire in 1830 after 27 years in Guangzhou, a colleague named John Latimer noted that America was no home to him. His habits had become so fixed that China was to him a home. Remarked Benjamin Wilcox on his return to Philadelphia, "I am unhinged, unsettled, idle, and of course irritable. Everything here loses in comparison with China. One reason the Americans felt loved in China was that in the early days they were generally well-behaved. They had no choice. From the Atlantic seaboard until they reached the Chinese mainland, Americans relied on the kindness of strangers. Their ships could not land at a single port without the approval of Britain or another European power. They traversed the pirate-infested waters of the Indian Ocean courtesy of the French Navy. Once in Guangzhou, the American merchants had no military to back up their demands and no diplomatic representative to negotiate on their behalf. So, unlike the frontiersmen in the American West who fought Indian tribes with an army behind them, America's pioneers in China sought harmony and peace. When Samuel Shaw first arrived in China in August 1784, it took him days and the intervention of a French captain to convince the Chinese that the Americans and the British were not the same. The Chinese initially called the Americans the New People, Shaw wrote, and the United States the Nation of the Flowery Flag. But after trying out at least 61 other options, the Chinese settled on a name for the land that these new people came from, Meiguo, or the Beautiful Country. With time, influential scholar officials in the Manchu court became well disposed toward the Yankee traders. In 1817, the Americans received favorable mention from Ruan Yuan, who governed two southern provinces, Guangdong and Guangxi. He praised Americans as the most respectful and compliant people from the Western world. Chinese merchants had a similarly favorable impression of the Americans. In his memoirs, Samuel Shaw recounts a bargaining session with a Chinese merchant who refused to buy Shaw's products at Shaw's stated price. This went on for a week, Shaw wrote, and Shaw negotiated politely throughout. The Chinese merchant was impressed and contrasted Shaw's civility with the surliness of most British traders. "All Chinaman very much love your country," the merchant told Shaw in pidgin English when he at last had accepted Shaw's terms. But the merchant also predicted that after a few trips to Canton, the Americans would lose their patience and make all same Englishmen, too. What pleased the Chinese merchants most about the Americans was that they paid for their tea, porcelains, and cloth with silver. For decades, America's main export to China was silver dollars, mined and minted in Spanish America. From 1807 until 1833, American ships hauled 2,225 tons of silver to China, more than half of all the silver China imported during that time. Just as American consumers injected billions of dollars into China's economy in the late 20th century, American merchants flooded the Middle Kingdom with silver in the early days of the relationship. U.S. silver exports to China played a key role in helping the Qing court right its balance of trade and postponed for many years the economic crisis brought on by the trafficking of Indian opium into China. As British drug sales in China skyrocketed, Chinese silver flowed into the coffers of the East India Company and private British trading houses. In 1807, the East India Company took 3.4 million silver dollars out of China, its first sizable export of silver, but Americans brought 6.2 million to China in that same year. The American trade imbalance with China was tough on the United States and its traders. One Cantonese merchant named Consequa sought President James Madison's assistance in collecting multiple debts. Yankees scoured the globe for products to replace silver. The first boom was in ginseng. Chinese had been consuming the American version of the root since the early 1700s, when a Jesuit priest discovered the plant in use among the Iroquois of North America. In ginseng, Samuel Shaw thought that he had chanced on the charm to unlock China's market. "Useless produce of our mountains and forests," Shaw enthused shortly after the Empress of China made landfall, was going to make him rich. But the ginseng boom soon turned to bust. The year before the Empress of China landed in China in 1784, ginseng had sold for $30 a pound, but Shaw could only get $4. By 1790, a pound of Yankee ginseng fetched barely 25 cents. Because of the Americans, the prices dropped, grâce Chrétien Louis Joseph de Guigne, the French consul in Canton. Even when the price fell to 16 cents, the pig-headed Americans just moved more of the stuff. In 1802, they brought 300,000 pounds to China. In 1824, 800,000. The price of wild American ginseng did finally recover in the 1990s. Today it's over $1,000 a pound, and most of it still goes to China. Sea otter pelts were next. The British had inaugurated the trade in 1784 off the coast of modern-day Oregon. 3 years later, the Americans arrived, and over the next decade, the Boston men, as the Indians called them, elbowed out the British. American ships took 200,000 pelts to China, worth $6 million in the currency of the day. By the mid-1820s, the sea otter had vanished from the Pacific Northwest. Traders from Connecticut specialized in seals. On Masa Fuera, a 7-mile-long rock 500 miles off the coast of Chile, Americans found 3 million of the creatures, wrote Amasa Delano in his memoirs. They were soon gone. From the mid-1790s to the 1820s, Americans killed more than 6 million fur seals. By 1824, the fur seal had disappeared from the waters around South America and from the islands to the south of Africa, where William Phelps had slaughtered them in his teens. In Hawaii and on Fiji, American traders found sandalwood, used for furniture and incense, and the oleaginous sea cucumber, which the Chinese ate. But in the end, facing a huge trade deficit and hoping to stanch the flow of silver into China, the Americans, like the British, began to run drugs. The Chinese had been sampling opium since the 8th century. In the early years, it was either eaten or drunk. By the beginning of the Ming Dynasty in the 14th century, it gained popularity among the well-heeled as an aphrodisiac and an after-dinner relaxant. In the 16th century, it became more widespread as it was combined with another import, tobacco. By the late 18th and early 19th centuries, opium was available in coastal Chinese homes. The American trader William Hunter observed that among his Chinese friends, smoking was a habit, as the use of wine was with us in moderation. The first American ships to carry opium to China brought it from Turkey in 1804, courtesy of two Philadelphians, Benjamin Wilcox, the gourmand consul with the love child from Macau, and his brother James. Chinese smugglers were happy to cut the more potent British product from India with what became known as Turkey. From the end of the War of 1812 to the mid-1830s, Americans bought more Turkish opium than any other nation. One Boston firm alone, Perkins and Company, regularly shipped one-half to three-quarters of Turkey's entire yearly crop of 150,000 pounds to China. By 1818, the Americans were buying opium in India as well, challenging the East India Company's monopoly on the drug traffic there. The U.S. entry into the opium trade coincided with an enormous increase in opium exports to China. In 1773, British ships moved 75 tons of opium to China. By the 1830s, American and British vessels were carrying more than 350 tons a year. In 1829, total British exports to China accounted for $21 million, about half of it from opium. American exports hit $4 million, of which opium constituted one quarter. The U.S. opium trade had reverberations at home. Within two decades, the opium traffic reversed America's trade imbalance with China. Silver poured back into the United States, contributing to sharp inflation in the 1830s. One American firm, D.W.C. Oliphant and Company, refused to carry the drug out of religious conviction, but most American merchants saw a good opportunity in moving Turkey to China. I do not pretend to justify the prosecution of the opium trade in a moral and philanthropic point of view, mused Warren Delano, an American opium trader in Guangzhou and the grandfather of Franklin Delano Roosevelt. But as a merchant, I insist that it has been a fair, honorable, and legitimate trade. Equivalent, he argued, to importing brandy into the United States. The vast gap between the Chinese and American cultures made for many clashes. When an American sailor allegedly killed a Chinese woman on September 29, 1821, the small American community in Guangzhou faced its first crisis. Would the Americans conform to the Chinese way of doing things, or would they defy the Mandarins? Francis Terranova was a Sicilian deckhand on the Emily, a 284-ton cargo ship from Baltimore. He was buying fruit from Ko Lung Shi, a peddler on a sampan, when Ko fell into the sea. The Chinese accused Terranova, who was unimpressed with the quality of Ko's bananas, of throwing an olive jar that hit Ko on the head and knocked her into the water. Others said that Ko had simply slipped into the water and drowned. Wang Ranren, the district magistrate, invited U.S. Consul Benjamin Wilcox to view the corpse. There was a gash on the right side of Ko's head, Wilcox wrote, into which the olive jar fitted exactly. Terranova, Wilcox thought, was guilty. The Chinese authorities demanded that the sailor be handed over. In negotiations with Wilcox, the Chinese agreed to a trial and to a Yankee approach to the proceedings. Witnesses for both the defense and the prosecution would be called. On October 6, 1821, a flock of Chinese warships surrounded the Emily. Led by Magistrate Wang, hundreds of Chinese officials and soldiers crowded onto the deck, dwarfing the American delegation of 40. None of the American witnesses spoke Chinese. When the Chinese interpreters arrived, they approached Wang on their hands and knees, leaving the impression that they would not be translating anything that the magistrate did not wish to hear. Unmoved by testimony from the Emily's sailors backing Terranova's story, Wang cut the hearing short. The Americans accused the Chinese of breaking their pledge to grant Terranova a fair trial. Wang then lost patience and pronounced Terranova guilty. The Emily's captain refused to hand over his deckhand. On October 7th, the Chinese suspended trade with the United States. The prospect of a trade embargo was too much for the Yankees. After 16 days, the Americans turned Terranova over to the Chinese. Before dawn on October 28th, he was taken to the office of the viceroy in Guangzhou and strangled. The British were shocked, more by American docility than by the execution. The Americans had barbarously abandoned a man serving under their flag to the sanguinary laws of this empire without an endeavor to obtain common justice for him, reported the Select Committee of the East India Company. To the British, the case brought home the need to live outside the purview of Chinese law. To the Chinese, it showed that even when China tried to placate foreign mores, the foreign devils would still be unsatisfied. The matter did not end with Terranova's execution. While the Sicilian was being tried on deck, the Emily held a load of opium in its stowage. Tipped off that the captain was smuggling drugs, Chinese authorities confiscated the cargo and sent the ship back to Baltimore empty. The Terranova case colored American views of China for years. Westerners cited it as proof that they needed extraterritoriality, under which foreigners policed their citizens on Chinese soil to ensure universal values and to protect the rights of the accused. The potent mix of money, drugs, and cultural differences that swirled around Guangzhou was bound to ignite. Amasa Delano wagered that British gunboats would soon attack China. In Delano's view, the emperor's unwillingness to fully open his country to trade with the West was a strategic mistake. "The English possess great power in Asia, both by sea and land," he wrote. "If they attacked, I think it would end in the dissolution of the present government of China." He would eventually be proven right. For the United States, however, trading with China not only saved, but helped shape the new republic. America's discovery of the China market was integral to the rise of the United States. For the Chinese, America also meant opportunity, for their officials, for their showmen, and for one globally minded businessman. Chapter 2. Founding Fortunes. In the early 19th century, the world's richest private businessman was Chinese. Wu Bingjian, a merchant prince from Guangzhou, had amassed a fortune estimated at $26 million in 1834, the equivalent of tens of billions today. He did it without leaving China, but with the help of his American friends. A cautious, even retiring man whose Chinese nickname was the Timid Young Lady, Wu was famed for his uncanny knack for figures and his kindness, especially to the New England merchants, which caused endless grumbling among their British rivals. To the Western merchants in Canton, Wu was known as Haokua or Hokua, the name he did business by. In the early 19th century, Hokua was appointed senior merchant of the 13 Hongs of Canton, which were authorized to deal with the Oceanic Barbarians in Guangzhou. At the time, the Hong system, under which a small group of merchants handled thousands of tons of tea and porcelain exports a year and were responsible for one another's debts, was viewed as one of the most efficient trading enterprises in the world. In the United States, this collective guarantee inspired lawmakers in New York to establish the first bank deposit insurance system, a precursor to today's Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation. Hokua's commercial interests stretched from China to India to London and the United States. His American investments, managed by a trusted Yankee friend, powered the development of railroads, real estate, manufacturing, and insurance. Some 150 years before American capital fueled China's modernization, money from the Middle Kingdom performed the same service in the United States. What drew Hokua to a series of Boston merchants over the first four decades of the 19th century is a story that has gone largely untold in the popular literature about China and the United States. But it is a sterling example of the persistent sense of a shared destiny and mutual self-interest that flowed between Americans and Chinese as they responded to a changing world. The idea, put forth in histories of the period, that the Chinese did not welcome foreign trade is not true. Although the Qing court adopted a patronizing attitude toward foreigners, and Confucian mandarins sniffed self-importantly at China's merchant class, the dynasty's policies were not anti-commerce. China's Qianlong emperor may have told a British mission led by Lord George Macartney in 1793 that "our celestial empire possesses all things in prolific abundance and lacks no product within its border." But his imperial household relied on taxes from China's trade with the West. The Manchus, a nomadic Asiatic tribe who ran the Qing, even employed trade to save the empire. When Manchu cavalry poured into China from the north in the early 17th century, they took Beijing first, establishing the dynasty in 1644 to rule over the Han Chinese. For the next 40 years, a struggle for southern China raged between the invaders and the remnants of the Ming court. In 1684, however, with southern China finally in the Qing's hands, the then emperor, Kangxi, opened the south for trade with the outside world. He promoted commerce to jumpstart the economy and win the allegiance of the south. To Kangxi, trade with the west was a glue to keep southern China in his realm. But the court worried that just as contact with the west could be used to win its subjects' loyalty, it could also shake the empire's foundations. So Kangxi restricted trade to a small group of men, the 13 Hongs, in one southern port. Encouraging commerce in Guangzhou made sense as a way to heal the wounds of war. But once Western merchants began to press for access to all of China, the throne saw them as a threat. These conflicting goals, of leveraging the West to strengthen the empire and restricting its impact to guarantee security, defined China's often contradictory responses to the capitalists from across the seas. Born in 1769, Hokua specialized in the most profitable sectors of the Canton trade, tea, money lending, and commodities, which included opium. He turned a profit first as a tea grower and then as a middleman. A portrait of Hokwa in middle age shows him swaddled in luxuriant finery, a fur-lined dark blue silk winter coat embroidered with a phoenix. The amber and coral necklaces draped around his neck offered a marked contrast to Hokwa's austere, even ascetic, mien. Hokwa adapted quickly to the new trend of replacing silver aboard ships with interest-bearing bonds. When dealing with millions of dollars floating for months on ships around the globe, he found that this scheme could be lucrative. Hokwa reached out to merchants in other Asian ports, Calcutta, Manila, and Batavia, and pulled Guangzhou, through which more than $25 million in exports float annually, into a global web of trade. In 1820, Hokwa cornered the Asian market in pepper. In the foreign ghetto, he honed his skills as a real estate baron, leasing several of his properties to Western merchants. His 1843 obituary in Britain's Asiatic Journal declared him the equal of any European merchant, and observed that to the last he directed his vast and complicated trade, which almost encircled the globe, alone. It called his business sense astonishing. Hokwa did not like the British, the journal acknowledged. His predilections were American, and justly so, seeing that he was indebted in an early stage of his career to a citizen of that country. That citizen was John Perkins Cushing. John Perkins Cushing arrived in China in 1804, the first year Hokwa did business with the Americans, selling them a boatload of tea. Cushing had been dispatched to China to serve as a clerk for the Boston firm Perkins & Company, founded by his uncle. Like many Americans in the China trade, Cushing was a teenager, and Hokwa took him under his wing. With Hokwa's guidance, Cushing matured from a 16-year-old with literary pretensions and scant interest in numbers into the shrewdest and most successful of all the American traders in Guangzhou. What pulled Hokwa to the Americans initially was their silver. He did not have to barter his tea for British woolens or manufactured goods. Moreover, as the leading Hong, Hokwa was caught between the overbearing British East India Company and corrupt mandarins. The East India Company bought in bulk, so it demanded lower prices. Qing officials squeezed Hokwa for bribes. The Americans were a perfect foil, allowing Hokwa to sell at a price higher than the British accepted and offering him a place where he could secrete his money beyond the grasp of the Qing court. New England merchants carried Hokwa's tea to London, skirting the East India Company. And Americans took his tea to the United States on their ships, evading the high duties that the U.S. government imposed on goods imported on foreign vessels. The Americans were amazed at the faith that Hokwa placed in them. "Unbounded confidence in Americans has never been equaled," wrote Paul S. Forbes, a Guangzhou-based merchant and one of Cushing's cousins. Entrusting to those with whom he had no ties of country, language, or religion between $2 and $3 million of dollars at one time. By the age of 19, Cushing had taken over the Perkins & Company office in Guangzhou. The eruption of the War of 1812 pushed him closer to Hokwa. The Royal Navy chased American merchantmen off the seas, so Cushing had little American trade to conduct. Instead, he ran Hokwa's overseas businesses. He moved into drug trafficking, and Perkins & Company soon had a near monopoly on opium from Turkey, supported by loans from its Chinese friend. Hokwa tried to cover his tracks, but did not always succeed. In 1821, after opium was discovered aboard his client's ship, the Emily, the emperor ordered that a sapphire button, a sign of Hokwa's status as an honorary official, be stripped from Hokwa's hat. Still, his Yankee business kept growing. Together, Cushing and Hokwa battled their British competitors. They subverted the East India Company's monopoly on British-made cloth and other British products that sold well in China. In one of China's first great intellectual property rip-offs, Americans and Chinese copied the East India Company's packaging trademark and dumped their cheaper cloth on the Guangzhou market. The East India Company complained to the Chinese and pushed the Qing court to crack down. but finally the British government moved to dissolve the monopoly in 1834, in part because it could no longer compete with independent merchants like Cushing, aided by the entrepreneurial Chinese. When wars of independence shook Latin America in the 1820s, Hoqua and Cushing moved in on the trade in silks and tea that Spanish Manila galleons had shipped to South America. In 1825, during a rice famine in Guangzhou, Hoqua persuaded Chinese customs authorities to reduce duties on Cushing's ships so long as they carried rice to China. This further spurred American drug trafficking as Yankee traders buried crates of turkey under the grain in their holds. In 1835, Hoqua donated one of his buildings, 3 Hog Lane, to American missionary Peter Parker to open, rent-free, the first Western hospital in China. The Hospital of Universal Love heralded the start of American support for China's medical sciences. Hoqua availed himself of Parker's care. The great merchant suffered from maddening bouts of itching each winter and chronic loose bowels. Despite the 4 months it took for mail to reach opposite ends of the earth, Hoqua and his American associates maintained an active correspondence. In 1837, Hoqua shipped John P. Cushing 54 pounds of mulberry seeds to start a silk industry in the United States. It failed. Hoqua's friends mailed him soap, a wood-burning stove, a rocking chair, barrels of flour, cookies, favored by Hoqua's oldest wife, and a cow that calved during the journey. The beasts were thin but alive upon landing. "With good care and plenty of good food," Hoqua replied, "they have both become quite fat, and the cow furnishes us with a most liberal quantity of rich milk." The Americans named a clipper ship after the businessman. Madame Tussauds in London fashioned his likeness out of wax. Hoqua's generosity was the stuff of legend. When Warren Delano prepared to return to the United States in the 1830s, Hoqua threw him a banquet that featured 2 kinds of soup, bird's nest and shark fin, and quail, sturgeon lips, and pigeon eggs. "We were 13 hours getting through with it," one American guest recalled. In 1827, Hoqua forgave a debt of $72,000 that Benjamin Wilcox owed him, allowing the Philadelphian to head home with no financial liabilities. Wilcox had earlier acted as Hoqua's principal debt collector in the United States, earning Hoqua's lasting gratitude. "You and I are number one, old friend," Hoqua told Wilcox and Pigeon as he ripped up the promissory note. As Cushing rose in prominence at Perkins & Company, he assigned another young clerk, John Murray Forbes, to Hoqua's account. Hoqua again treated an American teenager who had come to Guangzhou from Boston in 1830 at the age of 17, much as a son. While Cushing would live in China for 25 years, Forbes stayed only until he turned 23, returning to the United States in 1836, a wealthy young man. Months after he landed back in Boston, the Panic of 1837 rocked the United States, plunging the country into a 5-year depression. A year later, Forbes was ready to invest. Using the $100,000 he had saved in China, he established J.M. Forbes & Company, an investment bank. He augmented his seed capital with $500,000 from his mentor, Hoqua. In his letters, Hoqua insisted that Forbes alone manage Hoqua's American investments. As he had with Hoqua's teas, Forbes held Hoqua's money in his own name, but kept it separate from his own funds. "Although I made it a rule not to buy anything for it which I was not also buying for myself." Forbes invested in land, transportation, manufacturing, and railroads. One of his factories made the first rail ties in the United States. He ran the first passenger trains to Chicago from the east. In came immigrants, out went grain and cattle. Decades before Chinese labor built America's Western railroads, Chinese capital laid the groundwork. Forbes was not the only American to plant his Chinese proceeds in American soil. After hitting it big in Guangzhou, Abiel Abbott Lowe returned to New York City, built a fleet of trading ships, christening one of the vessels Hoqua, and invested in the first transatlantic cable and railroads, too. Americans in the China trade also became the nation's first great philanthropists. Forbes bankrolled the transcendentalist philosopher Ralph Waldo Emerson. Lowe supported education for women and funded libraries and hospitals. Lowe's son Seth built the Lowe Memorial Library, now the administrative center of Columbia University. The Astor family endowed Harvard. Other traders bankrolled Yale, founding its Skull and Bones Secret Society, and Princeton. From 75 tons a year in the 1770s, the opium trade to China had ballooned to 1,400 tons a year by the 1830s. Already, it was sucking millions of dollars of silver from China's treasury into the coffers of British and American trading houses. Its poison coursed through all levels of Chinese society. The Canton trade, which had helped pull the Chinese empire together, was now pulling it apart. For decades, the Qing court had debated how to deal with opium. A standoff between those who advocated legalizing and taxing the drug and those who favored a crackdown led to the worst possible solution. The trade was banned but tolerated, and a river of profits and payoffs flowed into the pockets of Qing bureaucrats and Chinese smugglers. In 1820, a new emperor, Dao Guang, took the throne. Several years later, after his eldest son apparently fell victim to the opium pipe, he vowed to take action. If the Qing government was conflicted about opium, so too were the Americans, for it wasn't only American business that was interested in China. In the 1830s, American Protestant missionaries started arriving in Guangzhou, bringing with them a negative view of the trade as opposed to the business community's decidedly amoral approach. Trafficking was wrong and had to stop, the missionaries said. The two sides squared off. Which mattered more, profits or principle? Was the goal to make money in China or to foster change? The battle continues to this day. In 1839, Emperor Tao Guang dispatched an official known for his uncompromisingly high moral standards to deal with the scourge. Commissioner Lin Seishu turned his sights away from Chinese drug dealers and addicts and trained them on the Western merchants. He proposed a barter deal, offering to swap tea for opium and a promise to end the traffic. When the Western merchants rejected it, on the afternoon of Monday, March 18, 1839, Lin ringed the foreign ghetto with Qing troops. "Hand over all the opium, and legal commerce can resume," he said. 6 days later, Charles Elliot, chief superintendent of British trade, arrived in the city and assumed responsibility for the drugs. By early May, Elliot had collected 15,400 chests of opium, valued at 6 million silver dollars. A tenth came from the Americans. Elliot handed them all over to Lin Seishu. The Americans announced that they were willing to forsake the opium trade. American manufactured goods and cloth were gaining traction in China, and the Yankee merchants believed that the dream of the China market was about to come true. "Our staunch friend Hoqua says if we don't cut the drug trade in toto, he will cut us," wrote Robert Bennett Forbes, a nephew of John M. Forbes, who had arrived in China in 1838 as chief representative for Russell and Company. By May 24th, Lin Seishu had lifted his siege of the foreign quarter. The British merchants then pulled out. By June, only 15 Americans and a handful of men of other nationalities remained in Guangzhou. Unlike the British, the Americans signed a pledge, brought to them by Hoqua, to end the opium trade. Commissioner Lin rewarded the Americans for their good behavior. On June 17, 1838, he invited a group of them, including Charles W. King, a merchant from a firm that had not run opium, and Elijah Bridgman, the first American missionary in China, to witness the destruction of the confiscated drugs. King and Bridgman were taken to a small island halfway between Macau and Guangzhou, where they found 500 workers crumbling cannonball-sized balls of opium into vast pits filled with water, salt, and lime. Once the opium had dissolved, the sludge was sluiced into a tributary of the Pearl River and out into the ocean from which it came. Have we anywhere on record a finer rebuke administered by pagan integrity to Christian degeneracy? Bridgman asked his readers in the Chinese repository, the American-operated paper in the city. King and Bridgman were ushered into a makeshift bamboo hall where Lin sat on a sofa. Short and stout, with a smooth, full, round face and a small black beard, Lin was vivacious and exhibited nothing that was barbarous or savage, Bridgman observed. It was no accident that only Americans had been invited to witness this historic day, Lin told them. They were, he said, decent and proper, with a predisposition toward being transformed and cultivated by Chinese civilization. Despite the patronizing tone, it was the highest compliment he could give. With his hands clean of opium, King assumed that he was entitled to a special deal and began a long tradition of American commercial behavior in China by seeking privileges during an audience with a Chinese official. King asked Lin to allow his firm to continue to trade during the crisis and to make up for his losses. Lin agreed to the first request but rejected the second. Lin was more concerned about the British. Why had they pulled out of Guangzhou? He asked. He wanted maps and other intelligence. When Bridgman and King spoke about Britain's naval power and its use of steam to power its ships, Lin once or twice raised a frown on his brow, Bridgman reported. Unbeknownst to the commissioner, China was on its way to a war with the mightiest power in the West. Before he withdrew from Guangzhou, British Superintendent Charles Elliot visited American merchant Robert Bennett Forbes and demanded that the Americans also depart from China and shut down trade with the empire. If your house goes, all will go, and we shall soon bring these rascally Chinese to terms, Elliot told Forbes. Forbes refused, telling the British representative that he would stay put in Guangzhou as long as I could sell a yard of goods or buy a pound of tea. When Elliot threatened the Americans with arrest, Forbes scoffed. America was a competitor for the favors of the Chinese court, a reality that has not changed much today. British traders, stuck outside Guangzhou with ships loaded with goods and needing tea for London, were less steadfast than the British superintendent of trade. They couldn't simply dump their cargo and go home empty-handed. So for the next 15 months, the handful of Americans living in Guangzhou and Macau undertook an astoundingly profitable river trade, sailing British wares to Guangzhou and the payment back to Macau for transfer onto vessels bound for London. By early 1840, British traders were forking over more to move their goods up and down that 90-mile stretch of water than it cost to ship the stuff to Europe and back. "While we hold the horns," one British merchant grumbled, "the Americans milk the cow." The river business, Robert Bennett Forbes confided to his friend and partner Samuel Cabot, was the best that Russell and Company had ever enjoyed. To meet the demands of the trade, FDR's grandfather Warren Delano bought a 900-ton British-built vessel and renamed it the Chesapeake. Then Commissioner Lin asked to buy it, and so the first American military sale to China came to pass. Lin turned the Chesapeake into a floating armory, outfitting it with Portuguese cannons and painting two great eyes on its bow to keep the foreign devils at bay. Charles Elliot would eventually thank Forbes for staying in Guangzhou. When they met later in Macau, he acknowledged that without the cover of the American flag, the British merchants would have lost millions. "My dear Forbes," Elliot said, "the Queen owes you many thanks for not taking my advice." In June 1840, a British expeditionary force under Rear Admiral Sir George Elliot, Charles Elliot's cousin, sailed into the mouth of the Pearl River with a fleet of 48 ships ready to punish China for impounding British property, even if it was narcotics. The British crushed their Chinese foes. The Chesapeake was an early casualty. The Chinese had no one with the skills to sail her. Her guns were pointed the wrong way, and the casks of gunpowder that had been stored on deck made too tempting a target. British Marines boarded her and put her to the torch. When the flames reached the Chesapeake's magazine, the great ship exploded, illuminating the sky for miles around. As loss piled upon loss, Commissioner Lin Zexu tried to entice the Americans into an alliance against the British. The Chinese offered the Americans a monopoly on the trade through Whampoa and money for capturing Englishmen dead or alive. The Chinese put a $50,000 bounty on Charles Elliot's head. Ruan Ren, the Governor General of Guangdong and Guangxi provinces, suggested abolishing all customs duties for American ships as a sweetener. "The American barbarians are sure to be grateful for this heavenly favor," he predicted. But the Americans did not bite. In the United States, the public followed the war with a lively interest and generally backed the Chinese. The War of 1812 and the burning of the White House was still fresh in many minds. Americans had supported a movement to turn Canada into a republic, and clashes with the British Army erupted along the Canadian border. American missionaries in Guangzhou had sounded an emotional appeal on behalf of the Chinese. Their reports on the evils of opium, sent to churches across America, turned many Americans against the war and the trade. "China has a perfect right to regulate the character of her imports," declared Hunt's Merchants magazine from New York City. On March 16, 1840, Caleb Cushing, a congressman from Massachusetts, rose to address the House Committee on Foreign Affairs. "The British practice of trafficking opium violated," he said, "all law, human and divine." Yankee practicality lurked behind Cushing's condemnation. With China trade in his blood, John Perkins Cushing was a cousin, he understood that Americans could profit from Britain's woes. But whereas Cushing saw a moral imperative and an opportunity in taking a different approach to China than the rapacious tactics of the British, his fellow New Englander, John Quincy Adams, believed that Britain was right to go to war. As the conflict intensified, Adams, who had been Secretary of State when the sailor Terra Nova was executed and was now chairman of the House Committee on Foreign Affairs, argued before the Massachusetts Historical Society that the British were not fighting simply for the right to traffic opium. There were broader principles at stake, such as free trade and the untrammeled intercourse between nations. The British, he said, wanted the Chinese to treat them as equals. "The cause of the war is the kowtow," Adams declared. The war was being fought to battle China's boasted superiority above every nation on earth. Adams's view was still in the minority. The North American Review, the leading intellectual publication of the day, declined to publish his speech. But it foreshadowed a continuing debate on how to deal with China. Should China be allowed to act as if it were a unique civilization that deserved special treatment, or should it be held to Western standards? In August 1842, China buckled to British military pressure. The court agreed to British terms and signed the Treaty of Nanjing. China ceded Hong Kong to the British Crown, opened up 5 treaty ports for trade, paid an indemnity of 21 million silver dollars, and instituted regular customs duties, abolishing the random taxes and fees that had so bedeviled Western traders. Writing to John P. Cushing in December 1842, Ho Kwa welcomed the end of the Hong system, which had handcuffed his world-class business acumen, golden though the shackles may have been. "I look forward with pleasure to the time when I will be a free man," he wrote, adding wistfully, "If I were a young man now, I should think seriously of embarking for America to settle down somewhere near you." His business partner, John M. Forbes, offered one of his ships to take the merchant's treasures and his family to Florida or an island in the Caribbean. "Come to this country," Forbes urged in a letter, "where every man is called upon to pay only his fair share of the expenses of the government." Ho Kwa never read the note. On September 4, 1843, 30 days after it was written and 3 months before it would arrive in Guangzhou, China's 74-year-old tycoon died at the Hospital of Universal Love. According to the notes of Dr. Peter Parker, a bout of diarrhea, brought on by the Manchu demand that Ho Kwa pay another bribe, had terminated the life of this distinguished merchant. Defeat in the Opium War finally drove certain leading figures in the Qing court to seek a systematic understanding of the Western world. Before that, Westerners had appeared in Chinese books in weird get-ups, as devils and monkeys, and always smelling bad. America was thought of as far off, very strange, and of little significance. One Chinese pamphlet placed the United States near Africa. Another called it an isolated island in the middle of the ocean. Commissioner Lin thought, given the American opium trade, that the United States was somewhere near Turkey. Now China had to dissect the West, and the Americans emerged smelling sweeter than everyone else. Chinese writers marveled at American democracy and at the idea that the American people, including the president, bowed to law and not to an emperor. American charities fascinated the Chinese. Commissioner Lin was taken with American education. America's prosperity was powered by its schools, which enabled talents to emerge generation after generation, he wrote in the Gazetteer of Four Continents, one of the tomes on Western powers that were produced during this period. Yankee industry impressed the Chinese. At least 150 years before U.S. pundits would hold up China's economy and its decisive leadership as a model for the United States, the Chinese saw things worthy of imitation in America. In the 1840s, Emperor Dao Guang tasked Xu Jiu, the governor of Fujian province, just north of Guangdong, with writing a history of the Western barbarians. Published in 1849, Xu's A Short Account of the Oceans Around Us lavished praise on America, and especially on its first president, inaugurating a Chinese cult of George Washington that would endure through the era of Mao Zedong. Xu gathered his information about America from David Abiel, a missionary from New Brunswick, New Jersey. Abiel had been in Xiamen, on Fujian's southern coast, since 1842, and found Xu to be the most inquisitive Chinese of a high rank I have yet met. He plied Xu with books and maps. Sadly for Abiel, none of Xu's curiosity extended to God. He was far more anxious to learn the state of kingdoms of this world, Abiel observed, than the truths of the kingdom of heaven. The story of America's fight for independence was of immediate relevance to a nation struggling to contend with the British crown. So it was natural that Xu devoted the longest section in his book to the United States. Americans, Xu wrote, were docile, good-natured, mild, and honest. No other country came closest to the Confucian ideal that everything under heaven is for the common good. Americans possessed what China wanted, he wrote, wealth and power. Three elements made George Washington's story gripping to a Qing dynasty scholar trying to determine what was wrong with China. First was Washington's selfless dedication to his country, a rebuke to the widespread corruption in the Qing court. Second, Washington had thrashed the British, China's foe. Third, in contrast to China's sclerotic monarchy, where the emperor clung to power until his dying day, Washington's return to civilian life served as a model of the cardinal virtues that Chinese sages had promoted from time immemorial. Just as Washington had mistaken the Chinese for Caucasians, Xu and his fellow scholars saw Washington's virtues as Chinese. Of all the famous Westerners of ancient and modern times, can Washington be placed in any position but first? Xu asked. Those lines would be etched onto a marble plaque and sent by Chinese merchants to Washington, D.C. in 1853. There, the administration of President Franklin Pierce mounted the plaque inside the 5-year-old Washington Monument, where it can still be seen today. Underlying Xu's short account was a simple yet profound insight. The old Mandarin conviction that China sat at the apex of world civilization no longer held true. China needed to look outside itself for answers to its quest for wealth and power, but most Qing officials were not ready for that perspective, and in 1850, when Emperor Tao Guang died and was replaced by a more traditionalist leader, Emperor Shan Feng, the court accused Xu Ju of inflating the status of foreign barbarians and banished him, along with other pro-Western officials, to the edges of the empire. The signing of the Treaty of Nanjing between Britain and China forced American politicians to pay attention to China. Britain spurred the United States to demand equal treatment. No longer could the United States remain aloof from the interests of American businessmen and missionaries in China. The first official American political engagement with the Middle Kingdom came with the arrival of the U.S. Navy's East India Squadron at the mouth of the Pearl River in April 1842, just after the Chinese surrender to the British. American Commodore Lawrence Kearney told Chinese officials that the United States would expect the same treatment that Britain had won. The U.S. government also got an inkling of how tortured its China policy would become. On the one hand, in response to merchants' requests, Kearney had been instructed to protect American interests. On the other, in reaction to the missionaries and public opinion back home, he had been directed to halt the American opium trade. Kearney published a letter warning American drug smugglers that he would not protect them from Chinese prosecution. He seized an American opium ship, the Ariel, but soon discovered that no American law justified taking action against narcotics trafficking. He could hold the Ariel only because her papers were not in order. Patrolling China's coast for more than a year, Kearney sought to show the Chinese that the U.S. Navy, unlike the British, had come in peace. On May 9, 1842, he hosted the local commander of the Chinese Navy, Admiral Wu Jianshun, aboard his flagship Constellation. Arriving in the afternoon, Admiral Wu was on high alert for treachery. Qing authorities had already ordered Chinese merchants to pay a huge bond, guaranteeing his safe return to shore. When American seamen conducted an exercise for the admiral's benefit, pretending to repel boarders from the Constellation's starboard side, Wu reacted in terror as almost 100 or more men with swords and pikes and fixed bayonets rushed up from the gun deck, wrote American missionary Elijah Bridgman, who doubled as Kearney's interpreter. Ultimately, the admiral relaxed, explored the ship, and lingered on board until sunset. The next day, he dispatched two aides to visit the American ship so that they, too, could witness a modern navy. Wu filed a detailed report on the Constellation to the emperor, omitting details of his anxiety attack. "Our ships are slow and clumsy," he complained, "but the vessels of the rebel barbarians turn their sails smartly." 2 days after Christmas 1842, Caleb Cushing, who had fulminated in Congress against the British a year earlier, warned President John Tyler in Washington that if the United States did not respond to the Treaty of Nanjing with its own treaty, the British would seize Japan and Hawaii, and with them, control of the Pacific. The future of the United States hung in the balance, Cushing claimed. 3 days later, in a special message to Congress, Tyler asked Congress to dispatch an envoy to China to negotiate an American treaty. Cushing got the job. From the start, Cushing viewed his mission as key to checking Britain's imperial pretensions and reinforcing America's interests in Asia. Cushing was also going to China as a representative of the Western world. "Civilization may have dawned in the East," he remarked during a speech before his departure at Boston's Faneuil Hall on June 17, 1843, "but now the sun of progress was shining on the West." "We have become the teachers of our teacher," Cushing said, a line that Americans would hear tossed back at them 165 years later at the height of America's Great Recession in 2008. Secretary of State Daniel Webster instructed Cushing to work to moderate China's repulsive feelings towards foreigners and draw a clear contrast with the British. "Tell the Chinese," Webster said, "that the United States, once a country subject to England, now meets England upon equal terms." Webster directed Cushing to show the Chinese that, unlike the British, who had grabbed Hong Kong, the United States did not covet Chinese territory. Cushing landed in Macau on February 24, 1844, and sent word to the Chinese that America wanted its own treaty. A few weeks before negotiations started in June, Cushing was handed a convenient pretext for demanding that Americans not be subject to Chinese law. Cushing had brought with him a new flagpole fitted with a weather vane in the shape of an arrow for the U.S. trading post in Guangzhou. The city was in the midst of a drought, and once the flagpole was erected, the Chinese insisted that the arrow, as it gyrated with the wind, was radiating evil spirits. A mob broke into the foreign ghetto to tear the flagpole down. U.S. Consul Paul S. Forbes calmed the crowd by agreeing to remove the weather vane, but elsewhere in the city, another group of Chinese attacked a group of Americans. One of the Americans shot and killed one of the Chinese, Xu Aman. As in the Terra Nova case, the Chinese authorities demanded that the Americans hand over their countrymen to face justice. Cushing refused and had the man tried by a jury of Yankee merchants. When he was acquitted, Cushing arranged for a payoff to Xu's family. In letters to Chinese officials in the run-up to talks, Cushing fixed on what was called the Aman Affair to promote the principle of extraterritoriality. He was determined to draw a protective ring around the Americans, allowing them to live in China but not under Chinese law. Treaty negotiations began on June 16, 1844, in a Buddhist temple just outside the walls of the Portuguese settlement. Cushing's counterpart, Chi Ying, a garrulous Chinese official, embraced the reserved New Englander upon their meeting. Dressed in a modified Major General's uniform designed to impress the Chinese, Cushing offered Chi Ying books on military tactics and fortifications, delicately suggesting that such information would be of value to China. Chi Ying, saddled with a superiority complex, declined the gifts. In a few decades, Chi Ying's successors would be begging America for arms and military advice. Over the next 2 weeks, the two men and their staffs hammered out a treaty. In messages to the Manchu court, Chi Ying sneered at the Americans for their stupid ignorance and their inability, compared with the better-trained British translators, to speak Chinese. But Cushing outwitted him. His first demand was for an imperial audience in Beijing. When Chi Ying rejected it, Cushing suggested that the Chinese agree to his terms for the accord, which expanded significantly on the Treaty of Nanjing. Chi Ying consented. The Huangxia Treaty of Peace, Amity, and Commerce between the United States of America and the Chinese Empire set the foundation for American ties with China for more than a century. Fundamental to it were the premises that America required equal access to China's markets and opposed carving China into pieces. Later, these ideas would be called the Open Door. The U.S. treaty opened the way for Westerners to participate in China's inland trade, giving Americans the right to use Chinese ports to move goods around the country and to send their warships into Chinese waters. Ignorant of economics and the law, Chi Ying had little idea what he was agreeing to. He focused chiefly on keeping Cushing from traveling to Beijing. The British treaty had stipulated that Westerners involved solely in criminal cases in China would be subject to their country's laws. Cushing, however, convinced Chi Ying to extend that protection to include civil cases as well. By allowing the treaty to extend the issue of extraterritoriality far beyond what had been detailed in negotiations with the British, the Manchu court created a mechanism that would humiliate China and threaten her sovereignty for a century to come. Cushing and Chi Ying concluded the treaty on July 3, 1844, a day before the 66th birthday of the United States. Cushing set sail for home in August, but not before Chi Ying gave him another hug and a massive portrait of himself in Manchu garb. It hangs today in the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston. The American press was fascinated by Cushing's journey to the Far East. In Pune, India, he rode an elephant to a Brahmin temple. On the island of Ceylon, The British governor feted him with a ball. He returned home by way of Mexico, only to stumble on the revolution that led to the Mexican-American War. In January 1845, Hunt's Merchants Magazine declared that the treaty he had negotiated would open a new era in the commercial world, second only to the discovery of this continent. Others were bullish, too. Around this time, Asa Whitney, a dry goods merchant from New Rochelle, New York, returned to the United States from Guangzhou. Twice bankrupted in America, Whitney had struck it rich in China and came home with an idea even more momentous than John Ledyard's sea otter schemes. Whitney became the first great prophet of the transcontinental railroad. Whitney's principal argument for what he called a great thoroughfare for all mankind was the prospect for trade from China. If America could build a railroad connecting its east and west coasts, Whitney promised audiences across the country, the United States would become the middleman between the Middle Kingdom and the entire world. Chinese commerce appealed to Americans as a way to bind their nation together, profit from old Europe, and unleash the productive capacities of the United States. Whitney's plan to secure federal grants for land from Lake Michigan to the California coast never got off the ground. By 1852, he had bowed out of public life and retired to his farm, but not before leading a survey mission to validate his route and convincing legislatures in 18 out of the then 30 states to approve resolutions in favor of the plan. Asa Whitney brought the idea of a national railroad into the American consciousness and provided the intellectual impetus for the 1862 Pacific Railway Act. Of course, the Transcontinental Railroad did not reroute global trade, nor did it ensure American hegemony over commerce between Asia and Europe. The Suez Canal, opened in 1869, ended that pipe dream. But once again, the inspiration that Americans took from China prompted change in the United States. Despite China's meandering foreign policy, the connections between China's merchant princes and New England's businessmen persisted. After Hoqua's death, John M. Forbes continued to pay regular dividends to Hoqua's descendants. From 1858 to 1879, the family received more than $60,000 silver dollars a year. Business records indicate that the Forbes group made out well, too, turning a profit of close to $1 million managing Hoqua's estate. Forbes's descendants, such as the family of Secretary of State John Forbes Kerry, remember old friends. To this day, a portrait of Hoqua hangs at the Forbes estate on Notion Island, just off Cape Cod. The visionary Yankee merchants who opened relations with China shared an irrepressible faith in the future of the United States and were eager to make their mark on an uncertain world. They found willing partners among the Chinese. The American idea of a special relationship with China began in the golden bonds forged between traders such as Hoqua and their American peers. Chapter 3. Blitz Conversion. In late March 1847, two Chinese men arrived at the Welting Baptist Chapel in Guangzhou. Wedged between a duck market and a pub, the chapel was the handiwork of Isaacar J. Cox Roberts, a fire and brimstone preacher from backwoods Tennessee. The two men were cousins and an unusual pair. There were fewer than 80 missionaries then, and the rare Chinese who went to see them were usually in search of something other than the light of the Lord, more likely a handout or a job. But this pair had not come to beg. They wanted to learn the gospel. When Roberts asked why, one proceeded to tell a wild tale of hallucinations involving an old man with a golden beard and his command to exterminate the demons. It was just the type of apocalyptic apparition that resonated with Roberts, who had been driven to devote his life to battling Satan by a vision that had come to him as he labored on his farm 12 years before. Roberts wrote to his friend William C. Buck, a Kentucky newspaper editor, about the two men. Following the hallucinations, one of them had stopped worshiping his ancestors, a practice that Christians considered blasphemous, and had convinced others to follow suit. Their arrival at his chapel, Roberts wrote, presaged the commencement of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit upon this benighted people. Buck printed Roberts' letter on the front page of the Baptist Banner and Western Pioneer in Louisville. The two men joined Roberts' Bible class. They learned the way a Baptist church operated, memorized hymns, and witnessed a baptism. They informed Roberts that in their village, 30 miles from Guangzhou, many others had abandoned their idols. They seemed eager to return home to preach, and after 2 months, the cousin who had recounted the story about his visions asked to be baptized. Just before Roberts was to immerse the man in the murky waters of the Pearl River, the man asked about employment. Roberts had no patience for what his fellow preachers called job-hunting rice Christians. He canceled the baptism, and he wrote, "Saw him no more." Not, that is, until 1860, when that man, Hong Xiu Chuan, stood at the head of the Taiping Rebellion, one of the biggest and bloodiest rebellions the world had ever seen, an uprising that cost the lives of up to 40 million Chinese and nearly brought the Qing dynasty to its knees. In his quest to overthrow the rulers of the world's most ancient civilization, Hong drew on the fevered Christianity of the American frontier and the faith he had learned from a farmer preacher from Tennessee. The relationship between Isaac R. Jacox Roberts and Hong Xiu Chuan embodies the bizarre but powerful attraction that China and America exerted on one another in the mid-19th century. Their brief encounter illustrates how outsized expectations have bedeviled relations between the two countries and their peoples. Roberts was part of a wave of American missionaries who believed that after its defeat in the Opium War, China was ripe for elevation to the ranks of Christian nations. Hong and others in his movement counted on Roberts to win Western support for their Christian rebellion and to smooth trade and diplomatic relations with the world's great powers. Their story, a proselytizer of American values expecting pro-American changes in China and a Chinese revolutionary counting on American support, would play out again and again, mostly with the same outcome: disenchantment on both sides. The battle between the Taiping rebels and the Qing Empire also touched off a struggle in the United States over how to deal with China. Though an American missionary lit the spark for the rebellion, a Yankee adventurer named Frederick Townsend Ward helped snuff it out. The time of the Taipings shows Americans at cross purposes in the Middle Kingdom. In American newspapers and church gatherings, Americans argued about what to do and which side to back in China. Some advocated pushing for a transformation of China. Others fought to keep China whole. This remains an ongoing debate. The rebellion also taught many leading Chinese not only to despise Christianity, but to fear it, a lesson that China's ruling Communist Party has inherited. The uprising convinced Qing Dynasty officials that the only way to meet the challenges of the modern world was through a Western-inspired program of reforms. To the Qing officials, the Taipings brought home both the danger and the necessity of an accommodation with the West. Americans had been involved in the mission to convert the Chinese since they first started coming to China. The first Protestant missionary, Robert Morrison, arrived in China in 1807 on a Yankee ship and for months pretended he was an American before acknowledging his British citizenship. China was a reluctant convert. Chinese merchants such as Hokua were delighted to make American dollars and American friends, but most of Hokua's 19th-century contemporaries were comfortable with their culture of Confucius, Buddha, and the Tao, and showed little interest in the holy goods the missionaries were hawking. In the first 27 years of their missionary work in China, Protestant missionaries claimed only 10 converts. One American preacher called a good year, two baptisms, and the marriage of one Christian Chinese couple. In letters, diaries, and books, many of the American believers, Roberts included, displayed an exasperation with, even a hatred of, Chinese culture. Many missionaries regarded Britain's victory in the Opium War as a sign that God was readying China for the arrival of the Word. "This land of heathenized infidelity has at last been thrown open," proclaimed J. Lewis Shuck, Robert's Baptist colleague, in a letter to American churchgoers soon after the 1842 signing of the Treaty of Nanjing. "However much we should regret to see war and bloodshed," Roberts added, "we are willing to see anything which has a tendency to accomplish these desirable ends." The opening of China to Christ. Roberts had arrived in China in 1837 after mortgaging his Mississippi farm and had started preaching in Macau. While the first group of Western missionaries studied Chinese and hobnobbed with the upper classes, Roberts was drawn to the masses. He preached to a leper colony on the outskirts of town. His first convert was a beggar. Roberts moved to Hong Kong and then, in May 1844, to Guangzhou. For 20 silver dollars a month, he secured 4 rooms and a kitchen in a building sandwiched between the street and the Pearl River. He was barely a mile from the foreign factories, but he could have been 1,000. To fit in, he donned a floor-length Chinese gown. His neighbors contributed to his wardrobe, donating Chinese socks and shoes. When aspiring mandarins flocked to Guangzhou for the annual civil service examination that year, some of them dropped by Roberts' mission. Roberts had been told that they were implacable foes of his work, but they sat politely through Sunday services. Roberts was a child of the Second Great Awakening, a revivalist crusade that had swept across the United States in the early 19th century. Opting for piety and fervor over education and expertise, the movement sought to fashion a religion suitable for a hardscrabble life on the frontier. The farmer preacher was the model. To many in the movement, book learning was at odds with God. The Great Awakening focused on domestic converts, settlers, freed slaves, and Native Americans. Its success, highlighted by massive backwoods tent revivals, swelled the movement's ambitions to bring about not just an American conversion, but a global one. America's view of itself as a nation blessed by God was central to this calling. The American Board of Commissioners for Foreign Missions began sending missionaries abroad in 1812. The Baptists, whose flock would grow from 10,000 before the War of Independence to more than 350,000 by 1845, followed soon thereafter. The first American missionaries were dispatched to Burma, India, and Ceylon. But China was seen as the biggest prize. The American Baptist magazine called Christianizing China the greatest challenge in the world. "Nowhere has Satan a seat on the earth to be compared in extent with that he holds in seeming triumph in the so-called celestial empire," the journal said. "From that seat he must be thrown down." Convincing Americans to move to China to preach was a hard sell. The tenacity of China's traditional culture, the unpopularity of the Christian message, and the harsh environment were not for the weak of heart. It was not until the 1890s that the number of American missionaries in China surpassed the number in India. Nonetheless, China was always the lodestar, the goal, in the words of renowned American evangelist Sherwood Eddy, who spent 30 years preaching in Asia. Its market for souls remained as tantalizing to America's missionaries as its nascent demand for goods was to American salesmen. Powered by the twin myths of Chinese need and American appeal, the United States' great spiritual expansion was underway. China quickly gained a privileged place in American hearts. During the heyday of American missionary activity from the late 19th through the early 20th century, Americans funded a majority of China's colleges and high schools and scores of Young Men's and Young Women's Christian Association, YMCA and YWCA, centers, as well as agricultural extensions, charities, and research institutes. By 1900, as fundraising campaigns became increasingly professional, 1 in 8 adult Americans, more than 5 million people, were dropping pennies for China into hats passed in church. From the turn of the 20th century, Americans dominated the missionary enterprise in China, which absorbed 1/3 of all American evangelists heading overseas. No other country came close to receiving that degree of attention. Like America's first businessmen in China, its pioneering missionaries hailed from the East Coast. Peter Parker, the fourth American preacher in China, landed in Guangzhou in October 1834. A graduate of both Yale's Medical College and its Divinity School, he was the first medical missionary to be sent abroad. Parker and the other early Protestants shared some similarities with the Catholic Jesuits who had been coming to China since the 16th century. Through good works, they sought to convince the Chinese of the superiority of their faith. Parker opened Guangzhou's first hospital, introduced anesthesia to China, and over his 3 decades in the country performed more than 50,000 surgeries, all for free. In his application to the American board, Parker described dual goals: disseminating the blessings of science and Christianity all over the globe. The barely literate Roberts, on the other hand, went straight for the Chinese soul. While Parker, in his high collar and starched white shirt, was hard at work at his Hospital of Universal Love, fitting Commissioner Lin Zexu, for instance, with a truss for a hernia, Roberts hit the streets of Guangzhou, peddling pamphlets and inveighing against ghosts. Full-body baptism was his goal for his converts. For China writ large, he imagined a sudden Christian awakening. What his mentor, Karl Gutzlaff, a German Protestant who dealt in opium and God for years along China's coast, called a blitz conversion. Peter Parker and Isaac R. Roberts disagreed about how to change China. Parker and others sent out by the American board believed that long years of study, an additional specialization, and a healthy respect for the culture were the keys to China's kingdom. They were scholars, not bomb throwers. They wanted, in Parker's words, to heal China, to help it become stronger and embrace Western values in the process. E.C. Bridgman, the first American missionary, translated Western learning into Chinese and founded an English-language newspaper, the Chinese Repository. The second missionary, S. Wells Williams, set up printing presses. Both men contended that it was not possible to sweep all of China's past into the dustbin of history and replace it with Christ. God could be discovered in the high moral character of Confucian teachings. China, they believed, had to be westernized one man and one woman at a time. In the 1950s, Americans repurposed this strategy and called it peaceful evolution. Parker and his contemporaries viewed with alarm the arrival of the Baptist strivers who saw little good in Chinese culture and embraced the sword instead of the scalpel. "We are not sorry that new laborers have come to this field of missionary labor," Parker wrote home after the Baptists appeared in 1844. He worried, however, that their bull in a china shop proselytizing, shouting at people in the street, picketing Chinese temples, would end in violence. Roberts, Parker wrote, was an indiscreet man, unsuspecting as a child, and unacquainted with human nature and the world. The Baptists scoffed at their old-school countrymen with their Christ-like patience. The Baptists wanted to cast aside the old China and create a new one modeled on America. As Roberts' colleague J. Lewis Shuck wrote to the Baptist mission in the United States, "Parker and company have no converts, no churches, and no extensive militant missionary operations, yet they regard it as interference for Baptist missionaries to come to Canton or Macau. Interfere with what?" One thing all the missionaries agreed upon, however, was that China was sick. Even as Roberts thundered against Chinese idolatry on the streets of Guangzhou, Parker was at the forefront of recasting the Chinese image in the United States. The Chinese, according to this view, were not a creative, powerful, or mysterious people from a great culture or a nation of carnival freaks, but a diseased mass craving a cure, and an American cure. For more than 2 decades, Parker engaged in one of the closest and strangest cultural collaborations between an American and a Chinese. From 1836 to 1852, in a studio on Hog Lane, next door to the Hospital of Universal Love, a Chinese painter named Guan Chiao Cheng, or Lam Qua to his Western clients, painted a gruesome series of portraits of 114 of Parker's patients. Parker had opened the hospital in November 1835 as an eye clinic, modeling himself on Christ, teaching the blind to see. He soon acquired a reputation as a highly skilled surgeon, and ophthalmology gave way to oncology. Parker specialized in removing tumors, many of which had been advancing for years. 900 patients streamed in within the first 3 months, suffering from massive growths. Before sending him to China, the American Board of Commissioners for Foreign Missions had ordered Parker to use his medical knowledge only as handmaids to the gospel. But the Chinese weren't interested in the gospel. They wanted Parker's handmaids, American medicine and American science. In 1837, Parker began teaching Chinese doctors Western medicine. By the time he left China in 1857, he had taught scores of students, but had logged few, if any, converts to his name. Parker asked Lamqua, one of the first Chinese trained in Western portraiture, to paint his patients before they went under the knife. One portrait is of Liang Yen, a 34-year-old woman with one good arm and the other disfigured by a tumor. In the case notes, Parker reported that Liang Yen twice canceled the operation to remove the tumor and her arm along with it. She demanded 200 silver dollars to let him amputate the tumor. Parker tried to persuade her that he was there to help her, but she did not trust him. Finally, under pressure from her husband, she acquiesced to the surgery. That interaction highlighted the deep ambivalence that many Chinese felt toward Americans, viewing men of God such as Parker alternately as ghoulish body snatchers or as superheroes. To Parker and Roberts, Liang Yen and her compatriots were either ungrateful wretches or pathetic invalids. How could they not understand that America had come to save them? Parker displayed the portraits on trips to the United States to raise money for his hospital and the Medical Missionary Society of China, which he had founded. The message back home was that China was ailing and that America had the cure. Like his preacher, Issachar Roberts, Hung Shu Chuan was an outsider. He was a Hakka, a subgroup of Han Chinese that had migrated south from north-central China centuries earlier. The natives of Guangdong province called them guests, implying that they would, one day, leave. Hong's introduction to Christianity had come in 1843, after he had failed an examination to become a Chinese official for the fourth time. In a pamphlet written by a Chinese convert, he found an explanation for the feverish visions that had followed an earlier failure on the test. In those visions, Hong had seen a golden-bearded man clothed in black. That must have been God, he thought. There was an elder brother who had to be Jesus Christ. Together they had slain some demons, who seemed to be Confucius and Buddha. Hong Shu Chuan baptized himself a Christian and declared himself the younger brother of Jesus Christ. Hong's first converts were his cousin, Hong Rengan, and a neighbor. They began proselytizing to friends and family, calling themselves the Society of God Worshippers. By 1847, when Hong traveled to Guangzhou to seek Roberts' guidance, the society counted 2,000 followers. From Roberts, Hong ingested a Christianity that stressed passion and morality. Though his understanding of the catechism was imperfect, Hong learned how to manage a church and deliver a sermon, knowledge that he would later employ in his rebellion. He made the Ten Commandments the bedrock of the Society of God Worshippers. He embraced the Baptist belief that baptism, preferably full body, was central to the conversion process. Roberts's personal war against Chinese idolatry colored Hong's views on the need to make a clean break with China's cultural traditions. By 1850, the Society of God Worshippers boasted 30,000 Han Chinese followers. The Manchu authorities were alarmed. In February 1851, in the Guangxi town of Guiping, the Qing army attacked, but the rebels dealt the Qing forces a crushing defeat. Hong's preaching turned more radical and more anti-Manchu. The Taiping Rebellion had begun. Roaring north from the mountains of Guangxi, the Taiping sped 900 miles to the Yangtze River, gaining converts as they fought. In March 1853, the great city of Nanjing, the first capital of the Ming Dynasty, fell to the rebels. That month, they proclaimed the founding of a new nation, the Kingdom of Heavenly Peace, or Taiping Tianguo. 2 months later, in Guangzhou, Roberts received an envelope bearing the seal of the Heavenly Kingdom. It was from his old student and the newly self-crowned Heavenly King himself, Hong Xiuquan. Though it is so long since we have met, yet I constantly cherished a remembrance of you, the note began, betraying no rancor over the aborted baptism of years earlier. Hong asked Roberts to join his rebellion, propagate the gospel, and baptize his followers. Your ignorant younger brother, Hong Xiuquan, salutes you, it ended. To have a former pupil in such an exalted position, the rebel king of China, presented enormous possibilities for China and for Roberts. Never were the prospects for usefulness with God's blessing brighter, Roberts enthused to a friend back home. They almost dazzle. China will be revolutionized, Christianized, and a great multitude saved through these means. Other missionaries shared Roberts' enthusiasm, looking to Hong's followers as the heaven-sent agents of China's blitz conversion. Hong's hopes and expectations in reaching out to his old friend were similarly grand. If the American preacher were to become a spokesman for the new Christian China, surely other Westerners would join his cause. There could be trade between the Taipings and their spiritual brothers from the West. If the riches and customs duties of Shanghai on the coast and Hankou up the Yangtze could flow into the treasury of the Kingdom of Heavenly Peace instead of the imperial household in Beijing, then China would be his. Among Hong's followers, faith in the United States ran high. His cousin, Hong Rengan, who rejoined the movement in the late 1850s after years in Hong Kong, looked at America as a model for the rebel nation. In a remarkable document, A New Work for the Aid of Government, identified by historian Stephen Platt as the first platform for reform in China's modern history, Hong Rengan reserved his deepest admiration for the beautiful country. China needed railroads like America's, mines like America's, a legal system like America's, and patent protections like America's, he wrote. China's old way of viewing the world with its empire as the center of the universe had to change. Its treatment of foreigners, calling them barbarians and expecting them to knock their heads on the ground before Chinese officials, was anachronistic in a modernizing world. Protestant societies, Britain and America, were the world's most successful, Hong concluded. China should become more like them. Isaacar Roberts journeyed from Guangzhou to Shanghai and requested permission from Humphrey Marshall, the U.S. consul, to travel into rebel territory. Responding that this would violate American neutrality in China, Marshall denied the request and threatened Roberts with execution if he attempted the trip. Marshall had little faith in Roberts' belief that China was ripe for Western salvation. A graduate of the United States Military Academy and a veteran of the Mexican-American War, Marshall was skeptical of the idea that a blitz conversion would cleanse China of its heathen culture. Instead, he saw the Taipings as a convenient excuse for Europeans, especially the British and the Russians, to carve up the empire into fiefdoms and close it to American trade. Instead of aid to the Taipings, Marshall advocated providing American military, commercial, and diplomatic support to uphold the Qing state. Marshall pleaded unsuccessfully with Secretary of State William Marcy for the resources to help the imperial government against the rebels. A weak China was bad for America, Marshall argued. It just made the Middle Kingdom a more tempting target for the empires of the Old World. Marshall appealed to the U.S. Navy squadron in Shanghai to assist the Qing, but its commander had no sympathy for his argument either. The squadron was led by Commodore Matthew Perry, who was far more interested in wielding his black ships to open Japan than to prop up the Qing. There is nothing to be hoped for in Japan equal to the advantages now actually enjoyed in China, Marshall wrote Perry in June 1853. Perry set sail anyway, entering Tokyo Harbor a month later on July 8, 1853. Instead of providing troops, Washington sent Marshall a pink slip. Learning of his dismissal in a newspaper article, Marshall left China on January 27, 1854, but his ideas stuck around. Marshall was the first American official to contend that China's weakness was a matter of concern to the United States. In doing so, he added a key corollary to the Cushing Negotiated Treaty of Wangxia. Not only did the United States need equal access to China's markets, but, as Marshall argued and generations of Americans would later agree, a strong China was in the interest of the United States. When Nanjing fell to the Taipings in 1853, the world took notice. The New York Times called the rebels America's natural allies. Many Americans saw the conflict in the context of their own history. Here were a people, the Han Chinese, rising up against the Manchus, an alien overlord. Karl Marx, writing in the New York Daily Tribune, framed the rebellion as part of a global uprising against capitalism that had started in Paris in 1848. W.A.P. Martin, a well-known Presbyterian missionary from Indiana, published an open letter to the U.S. government in the North China Herald, declaring that now there were two Chinas, a Christian China headquartered in Nanjing, overseeing the affluent tea and silk-producing regions of the Yangtze Valley, and the decaying Chinese Empire of the North. He called on the United States to recognize Christian China and throw open its portals to unrestricted intercourse. Peter Parker, so recently an opponent of Roberts, had come around as well, writing from Guangzhou that it was time to recognize the Taiping rebels and hasten the fall of the Qing. Critics, however, observed that the rebellion possessed an air of blasphemy. After all, Hong Xiu Chuan had pronounced himself the younger brother of Jesus Christ, and his prime minister had assumed the title of Holy Ghost. No recognition occurred. Meanwhile, outside Shanghai, an army of 500,000 Taiping rebels mustered. Panic shook the foreign settlement in the city, which had fast become the most important of China's treaty ports. Wealthy Chinese fled. Those remaining marshaled the city's defenses. Roberts was getting nowhere in his quest to help spread the word for Hong and his revolution. Refused passage on several ships heading to Nanjing, the Tennessee preacher found himself broke and out of a job. The Southern Baptists had fired him after he ignored a plea from an American colleague who had attempted suicide. His second wife, Virginia Young, whom he had married in 1850, had given birth to a son in 1853 and a daughter a year later. Roberts decided to return to the United States to settle his family and raise funds for the work that awaited him with the Taipings. Helped by his old friend William Buck, editor of the Baptist Banner and Western Pioneer, Roberts collected $24,000 from small donors across the South. Energized by a barnstorming speaking tour across the United States, Roberts was again convinced that China stood at the cusp of great changes. Writing from New York Harbor on January 24, 1855, he declared that he was ready to go to Nanjing to guide Hong and his believers with a vigorous hand in the way of truth as it is in Jesus. Meanwhile, as Humphrey Marshall had feared, the Manchu authorities, weakened by the Taipings, were bending to British and French pressure for more territorial concessions. Unlike Japan, which would respond to capitalism's challenge with wholesale westernization, China, under the reign of Emperor Xianfeng, who had taken the throne in 1850, had refused to reform. In 1856, the British and French forces attacked China again, beginning what was known as the Arrow War. The new war found Americans less supportive of China than they had been in the last one. U.S. naval forces joined in several battles, marking the first time that Americans had killed Chinese in combat. Peter Parker, who had since become a U.S. diplomat, argued that America should follow the European lead and seize territory. He advocated annexing the island of Taiwan, located 100 miles off China's southern coast, as a coal depot for the Navy and a base for trade. It was the first time that the island would arise as an issue between the U.S. and China. President James Buchanan's administration ignored the proposal. In an editorial on August 20, 1858, the New York Times praised the British and the French for using their cannons to further force China to open its doors to trade, and lambasted Washington for its passivity. It was humiliating, the paper said, that the United States allowed others to do the work and reap the honor while we are content enough to pocket the profits. The British and French assaults on China ended in October 1860 with the sacking of Beijing's Garden of Perfect Brightness, a vast expanse of European-style palaces designed by Jesuit missionaries. Sickened by the news that Europeans had torched his favorite Beijing citadel, Emperor Xianfeng would die within a year. Defeated, the Chinese signed the Treaty of Tianjin, known with no hint of irony as the Treaty of Peace, Friendship, and Commerce. 10 more treaty ports were opened. Foreigners could travel anywhere. Christians were protected. Opium was legalized. And most troubling to the Qing court, Britain and the rest of the Western world were allowed to station representatives in Beijing, implying that foreigners were equal in status to the Son of Heaven. In the American version of the treaty, the Chinese, still believing that the United States was more virtuous than the other powers, added a clause committing both sides to help one another in times of conflict. In return, the American missionary S. Wells Williams, who had joined the U.S. negotiating team in Tianjin, convinced the Chinese to agree to 4 articles promising to tolerate all religions and to allow Protestant missionaries to buy land anywhere in China, not just in the treaty ports. For the first time, the United States was advocating not just for Americans in China, but for Chinese Christians as well. This represented an unprecedented escalation of American involvement in China's internal affairs and laid the foundation for the lasting belief that how China dealt with its people was of concern to the United States. In October 1860, as Western forces were looting Beijing, Issachar Roberts, now 58 and sporting a white beard, finally arrived in Nanjing, having hitched a ride on a steamer up the Yangtze River. Roberts had expected to serve as the spiritual advisor to the Heavenly King. Instead, although he had never really mastered Chinese, he was put to work as an interpreter. It took days to arrange a meeting with his old disciple, Hong Xiuquan. The Heavenly King promised to put Roberts in charge of religious affairs. Hong issued a decree proclaiming religious toleration throughout the kingdom and ordering the establishment of 18 churches in Nanjing alone. Roberts would spend the next year trying to sway Western policy in favor of the rebellion. He sent letters to newspapers in China, Hong Kong, and the United States. From Hong's cousin, Hong Rengan, he relayed a promise that the Taipings were open to doing business with the West. Facts on the ground proved his point. When Taiping forces took the treaty port of Ningbo just south of Shanghai in December 1861, they asked Westerners to stay. Missionary W.A.P. Martin noted that trade in Ningbo jumped under Taiping rule. But history was not on Roberts's side. With the concessions wrung from the Manchus following the Arrow War, many in the diplomatic community agreed with the British consul, Frederick Bruce, that a weak Qing dynasty was better than a strong kingdom of heavenly peace. Bruce argued that the West should support the Qing. Western missionaries, dismissive of Hong's claims to being another son of God, distanced themselves from the movement and smeared Roberts. He was a vexatious crank, said Tarleton Perry Crawford, a fellow Baptist preacher from Tennessee who visited Nanjing in the spring of 1861. Roberts, he wrote, lives in a miserable old dirty room, has no power or influence among the rebels except in his own vain imagination. By January 1862, Roberts was the only missionary left in Nanjing. Then on January 13th, even he fled the city on a passing British warship. Crushed because the Taipings had rejected his spiritual guidance, Roberts, once the Taipings' biggest booster, became their fiercest critic. He falsely accused Hong Rengan of killing an aide. He called Hong Xiuquan a crazy man. Roberts's defection left the movement without a Western patron, severing the flimsy link between Protestant missionaries and a Chinese Christian revolution. Led by Frederick Bruce and Admiral James "Fighting Jimmy" Hope, commander of British forces in Shanghai, the British entered China's civil war on the side of the Qing. But because they were technically neutral, they needed a cover. That opened the door for another American to bend the arc of Chinese history, Frederick Townsend Ward. Like many of the Americans before him who had made their mark on China, Frederick Townsend Ward steered clear of the U.S. government. A native of Salem, Massachusetts, Ward did not go to China as a trader, sailor, or diplomat, but as a soldier of fortune. Rakishly handsome, with a mane of shoulder-length hair, dark eyes, and a lanky frame, the not-quite-29-year-old arrived in China in 1859, penniless and seeking adventure. He had originally aimed to throw his lot in with the Taipings, but like Roberts, he had trouble making it to Nanjing. So, using a French steamer named Confucius as his base, he battled river pirates for Chinese merchants. Impressed by their hired guns' derring do, the merchants encouraged Ward to defend Shanghai's outlying towns against a Taiping invasion. Hong Xiuquan and his generals had decided in May 1860 to attack the city, and word of their plans had crept along the rumor mill into Shanghai. On Shanghai's docks, Ward recruited a ragtag army of Filipinos, Malays, Brits, Americans, and Europeans, offering them a share of any loot that they could pilfer while protecting the city. Financing for this effort came from a Ningbo banker named Yang Fang. Behind the scenes, Qing authorities lent encouragement while trying not to advertise their reliance on a barbarian American for the city's defense. The authorities knew that, ever since the Opium War, Chinese soldiers, even rebels, held Western soldiers and Western firepower in almost mystical regard. What better way to secure Shanghai than with a force of foreign devils? Ward named his band of mercenaries the Shanghai Foreign Arms Corps. They came equipped with Colt revolvers, Sharps repeating carbines, and a babble of languages. From 1860 into the first half of 1861, they fought the Taiping. Despite the high death toll, during one battle, Taiping regulars gunned down 40% of Ward's force of 250, there was no shortage of recruits. Looting was more lucrative than dock work. For his pains, Ward suffered a shot to the face, leaving his speech permanently slurred. He was also awarded honorary Chinese citizenship, allowing him to escape prosecution for violating American neutrality laws. And he won a Chinese bride, Yang Fang's daughter. Ward proposed forming a force of American-led Chinese fighters. Qing officials agreed, and Ward became the first foreign officer in the Qing army and the first Westerner to introduce Western military tactics to the Middle Kingdom, unwittingly initiating a long history of American involvement in China's military reforms. In the summer of 1861, Ward established a training camp in Sungjiang, northeast of Shanghai near the Taiping lines. At first, the Chinese writers mocked their countrymen under American command, dubbing them fake foreign devils. But Ward kept training, and by January 1862, he had 3,000 troops ready for action. That winter, Ward led his new army into battle beneath a banner emblazoned with the Chinese character Hua, the Chinese approximation of his last name. First, a snow-covered town 10 miles north of Shanghai, then four other hamlets fell to Ward's forces. Much larger Taiping armies fled before his troops. Ward was wounded again and lost a finger to a musket ball. In one battle near Ward's Sungjiang headquarters, the American-led Chinese soldiers beat back an onslaught of 20,000 Taipings by luring them into an artillery ambush. The Taipings called Ward's men devil soldiers. In March, the Qing government officially named Ward's contingent the Ever-Victorious Army. Ward was allowed to wear a peacock feather in his cap, an exalted honor for a barbarian from the beautiful country. Ward's exploits came to the attention of a brilliant 30-year-old Chinese officer, Li Hongzheng, beginning Li's half-century association with Americans. The thing that first impressed the Americans about Li Hongzhang was his size. More than 6 feet tall, he towered over most Chinese and many Westerners. He has a keen eye, a large head and wide forehead, and speaks with a quick, decisive manner, observed one American journalist. Americans appreciated that Li, unlike many Chinese mandarins, did not fear railroads, mines, or the telegraph, and was eager to develop China. He was what the Chinese would call a self-strengthener, a man who believed that China needed Western technology and even some Western ideas to become rich and strong. Li had been fighting the Taipings in central China since 1853 with a force of more than 100,000 men. In the spring of 1862, the Qing court sent him to defend Shanghai. For Li, who had never before dealt with foreigners, arriving in China's most cosmopolitan city was a shock. Westerners dominated the town and controlled its defenses. British and French troops numbered about 3,000. Ward commanded the same number of Chinese. Li worried that the British and French would use their military positions in Shanghai to expand their influence. So, as he would do on many occasions in the future, he tried to bolster an American, in this case Ward, as a counterweight. Ward was happy to oblige, and by June he was reporting to Li. While Li tried to keep British and French military activity confined to the city limits, he gave Ward freedom to roam, using the ever-victorious army as the shock troops of Imperial Army assaults against the Taiping. Ward called Li the devilish governor, and Li was often exasperated by his American lieutenant's incessant demands for payment. But the two generals got along anyway. Ward's men trained Li's army, and Li used Ward's connections on the Shanghai waterfront to acquire guns and ammunition. When another Qing official complained to the court that Ward had refused to shave his head and wear a queue like other mandarins, Li declared that he would not allow petty faults to impede their partnership. Li credited Ward with saving Shanghai. "Such loyalty and valor," he told the Qing court, "is extraordinary when compared with these virtues of the best officers in China." By September, Ward's force had ballooned to more than 5,000 men. Li was so impressed with Ward's fighters that he wanted the ever-victorious army to attack the Taiping capital at Nanjing. Given Ward's skills as a commander, Li predicted, Nanjing would fall in 9 days. But on September 21, 1862, as Ward led his men in an assault on Shaanxi, 10 miles outside the Taiping-occupied treaty port of Ningbo, a bullet pierced his gut. He died the next morning, demanding with his last breath that his family be paid the money Qing authorities owed him. It never was. Calling the American Hua a great man, a soldier without fear and blameless, the Qing court ordered the construction of altars and a Confucian hall in his memory. The communists desecrated them after China's revolution in 1949. A British officer, Charles Chinese Gordon, took Ward's place, assuming command of the ever-victorious army. As for Isaac R. Roberts, he returned to his family in the United States in 1866. 5 years later, at the age of 69, he was dead, felled by leprosy contracted in Macau during his early hopeful days preaching to the heathen Chinese. Isaac R. J. Cox Roberts represented a major strain of thinking in America's hopes for China, that it could be converted in one miraculous stroke into a nation like the United States. Such hopes did not die with the Tennessee evangelist. Simultaneously, however, Americans with a different vision of a China that was stable, strong, and open for American trade were hard at work. One of them was heading to the northern capital, Beijing. Chapter 4. The Calm Minister. Carried on the shoulders of 8 Chinese porters in a sedan chair borrowed from the French government, Anson Burlingame bobbed into Beijing on July 20, 1862. The first American minister assigned to the capital, he arrived, accompanied by his wife Jane, their 2 sons, and their 6-year-old daughter, with no place to stay and a tiny budget. He also had no guidance from President Abraham Lincoln and Secretary of State William Seward, who had far greater problems on their hands than U.S. relations with China. Nonetheless, Burlingame would become one of the most revered Americans in 19th century China. The Chinese called him Pu Anchen, Calm Minister Pu. In the mid-19th century, few, if any, of America's tiny corps of diplomats sought positions in China. The relationship was largely in the hands of merchants like John P. Cushing, missionaries like Peter Parker and Issachar Roberts, and adventurers like Frederick Townsend Ward. The pay paled in comparison with postings in Europe. At the time of Burlingame's arrival, the U.S. legation worked out of a rented house in Macau on China's southern coast. The United States, alone among the treaty powers, trained no interpreters. In Shanghai, six men served as consul over a 9-month stretch in 1858. The consulate there occupied a single hotel room and didn't own an American flag. Although the Treaty of Wangxia had granted the United States, like other Western nations, the right to police its citizens in China, the U.S. would not establish functional jails and courts there until the early 1900s. In the meantime, foreign crooks claimed American citizenship to avoid jail. In Shanghai, a city famed for its foreign brothels, the term American girl signified not a perky debutante, but a prostitute. The United States authority was laughed at, and our flag made the cover for all the villains in China, Burlingame complained to his Secretary of State. After a month of bunking at the French legation, Anson Burlingame and his wife found a tiny home near the British, French, and Russian legations that fit his budget of less than $500 a year, 1/15 of the salary paid by the British crown. The residence, just south of the Forbidden City, home of the Qing court, was so small that Burlingame could not offer American visitors a bed. The entrance to the courtyard was so narrow that the sedan chairs of Chinese officials could not squeeze through, forcing mandarins to alight in the street and drag their gowns through the mud. Still, the couple transformed their humble embassy into the social center of the small world of foreigners in the northern capital. As Jane wrote to her father during their first winter, "We are scarcely ever alone. Sometimes there are callers from morning till night." Like Issachar Roberts, Burlingame was a child of the American frontier and an evangelical of sorts, promoting faith not in God, but in the American dream of freedom and equality. He was an avowed abolitionist and the first of dozens of such Americans, most of them members of the Republican Party, who would fight for China with the same zeal with which they had battled slavery. But where Roberts aggravated even those who agreed with him, Burlingame, with his prodigious side whiskers and expansive forehead, exuded a magnetic combination of Western grit and East Coast panache. He had grown up in Michigan and had accompanied survey parties around the Great Lakes. He had attended Harvard Law School, married into a prominent Boston family, won a seat in Congress in 1855, and helped found the Republican Party. Burlingame catapulted to fame in the spring of 1856 when a Southern congressman, Preston Brooks, challenged him to a duel after Brooks had brutally pummeled Senator Charles Sumner, a passionate opponent of slavery and a proponent of Chinese immigration, on the floor of the Senate. Once Brooks learned that Burlingame was a crack shot, however, he backed out. After Burlingame lost his congressional seat in 1861, the same bumptiousness that had won him praise in the North made him a liability for the Republicans. Party stalwarts referred to Burlingame and radical abolitionists like him as noisy jackasses. Lincoln ultimately sent him to Beijing. If Secretary of State William Seward, the clean-shaven former governor of New York, hadn't spent most of his energy fighting the Civil War, he would have focused on Asia. Seward believed that America's future lay in the Pacific. He opposed European plans to carve China into spheres of influence. He wanted China open for U.S. business and for mission work. Seward gave Burlingame what Jane Burlingame called carte blanche to fashion a China policy along those lines. Burlingame agreed that China needed to be modernized, but, unlike many of his more impatient countrymen, he did not hold that American progress could be shoved down unwilling throats. To change the West's policy toward China, he needed British help. Her Majesty's government remained the resident power in Asia. In 1861, England's Far Eastern forces boasted 66 warships and 8,000 men. The United States had neither ships nor sailors. Commodore Perry and his tiny East India squadron, established in the 1830s, had been called home to fight. Burlingame directed his substantial charm at British Minister Frederick Bruce, who had moved to Beijing from Shanghai, and the two formed a mutual admiration society, as Jane Burlingame put it. Bruce would show up unannounced and deposit himself in an armchair in the American sitting room, while Burlingame's daughter Gertie climbed into his lap. Bruce liked Burlingame's idea of a new approach to China. The Arrow War had given Britain, France, Russia, and the United States almost everything they wanted. More open ports and more freedom to proselytize and trade. The challenge now was to nudge the Qing in the direction of implementation. Burlingame called the new approach to China the cooperative policy. Like the ousted Shanghai consul, Humphrey Marshall, Burlingame argued that the West should protect Chinese sovereignty. He contended that China should not only bear the responsibilities of international law, but should also partake of its benefits. "He insists," Bruce wrote sympathetically to the Foreign Office in London, "that this opportunity is unique at the commencement of a new epoch in China's history." In a sense, Burlingame was right. Emperor Xianfeng's death on August 22, 1861, marked the end of a decade that featured an aggressive anti-Western foreign policy and the start of another spasmodic shift toward accommodation with the West. A 5-year-old emperor, Tang Xi, the son of Xianfeng and his favorite concubine, the 5-foot-tall Cixi, assumed the throne. Real power, however, lay with Cixi, known as the Empress Dowager, and a series of senior provincial officials such as Li Hongshang, who would dominate China until the fall of the Qing. Western historians have not been kind to Cixi. Following cues from communist Chinese historians, academicians have generally portrayed her as a scheming autocrat who stymied reforms. But to be fair, she had an impossible job, trying to steer a course between grasping imperialists and competing factions in her court. In the early 1860s, Cixi's sometime lover, the Manchu Prince Gong, who favored compromise with the West, launched a series of economic and educational reforms. He established the Zhongli Yamen, China's first government department devoted solely to foreign affairs. Officials who had earlier been exiled for praising the West were summoned back to work. Among them was Xu Jiu, the author of the early history of the West who had heaped praise on George Washington. Rehabilitated at age 70, Xu compared himself, restored to government work, to an old woman who dreams again of sex. To celebrate Xu's re-employment, Burlingame presented the Zhongli Yamen with a copy of Gilbert Stuart's portrait of Xu's hero, George Washington. Xu was put in charge of the first Chinese government school in the capital to teach Western knowledge, the Tongwen Guan. But like so many Chinese working with foreigners, Xu was hounded by xenophobes and, after a year at the helm, pleaded with the Empress Dowager to allow him to retire. She relented and replaced him with the American missionary W.A.P. Martin, who had so recently backed recognition of the Taipings. Martin would run the Tongwen Guan for the next quarter century. Chinese hardliners fought the idea of a Western-style school, especially with a Western dean. "I have never heard of anyone who could use mathematics to raise the nation from a state of decline or to strengthen it in time of weakness," scoffed Warren, a Manchu tutor of the emperor. "Besides," he added, "if astronomy and mathematics had to be taught, why should it be by barbarians?" Some Westerners also deplored the idea of giving China ideas that it could use in its own defense. When French Minister M. Klikowski found out that Martin had created a word for rights in Chinese and had translated into Chinese a treatise on international law, he shouted, "Who is this man who is going to give the Chinese an insight into our European international law? Kill him. Choke him off. He'll make us endless trouble. Prince Gong realized that to meet the challenge from the West, China needed to follow Japan's tack, open its doors to trade, improve its economy, and build its strength. In a memorial to the emperor in early 1861, Prince Gong laid out a strategy. To counter the West, China needed to show it a friendly face. Resort to peace and friendship when temporarily obliged to do so, he wrote, but use war and defense as your actual policy. According to Gong, China faced three challenges. Internal rebellions of the Taipings and another band in northern China called the Nian, the near barbarians, Russia and Japan, and finally the far barbarians, Great Britain and France. Gong proposed dealing with the rebellions first, then with the Russians and the Japanese, and last the Europeans. The Americans got special mention. The American barbarians are pure-minded and honest in disposition, and have always been loyal to China, Gong argued. The problem is how to control them to make them exploitable by us. That problem would perplex Gong and his intellectual descendants for the next 150 years. A month into his stay, Burlingame was granted an audience with Prince Gong. With both nations racked by rebellion, Burlingame cannily drew a parallel between China and the United States. He conveyed his sympathies to the Qing court in his fight against the Taipings and expressed support for the empire. China's reformers had found an American friend. Nevertheless, anti-foreign feelings ran deep in both the court and the country. Western missionaries, now permitted to preach and own property in the Chinese heartland, had spread to all corners of the realm. The number of missionaries would jump from 100 in 1800 to 4,000 by the turn of the century, with Americans leading the way. From 1860 on, the fires of a xenophobic, anti-Christian hatred would burn in many Chinese hearts, stoked by those in the upper class and others with bad memories of the Taipings. To gain traction with the average Chinese, China's traditionalists, men like Warren in the court, needed something dark to say about foreigners that would grip the imagination of China's people. They settled on sex, and through pamphlets, popular songs, and posters, they spread tales of Western missionaries and their allegedly aberrant sexual escapades. In 1861, an essay called A Record of Facts to Ward Off the Cult, written by an anonymous author who identified himself only as the most heartbroken man in the world, appeared throughout the empire. The record painted a grim picture of Christian mission activity as a non-stop orgy, including sodomy, pedophilia, and torture. Sunday services, it said, began with a short sermon, after which they copulate together in order to consummate their joy. Converts were said to smear their faces with menstrual blood, which explained the wild animal smell of most foreigners. The record was the first major effort by the conservative faction in the Qing court to demonize the West. It would not be the last. Burlingame was aware of the record, but as American officials would do in the future, he paid little heed to anti-Western misinformation and concentrated instead on winning hearts and minds through concrete deeds. He helped the Zhongli Yamen wriggle out of a bad deal with the British to build China's navy. He advised Prince Gong on how to wield international law to prevent the Prussians and the Danes from fighting in China's territorial waters during the German-Danish War of 1864. The records of Qing officialdom are punctuated with glowing accounts of calm Minister Pu. He was gentle, smooth, respectfully suave, well-bred, even-tempered, fair-minded, noble, and sincere at heart. Prince Gong had once been fanatically anti-Western. Routine contact with Burlingame mellowed his views. The prince even became comfortable with foreigners and struck Americans as different from the average Mandarin. His voice is low and soft, and his gesticulations more those of an Italian than a Chinaman, wrote one American contemporary. Burlingame went to bat for China with diplomats from other countries. In what would become an enduring refrain in Chinese-American relations, he insisted that China be held to different standards than other nations. On New Year's Day, 1863, Prince Gong gave Burlingame a letter of salutation to President Lincoln from the Emperor, who claimed in it that heaven had commanded him to govern the world. Burlingame ignored the phraseology which restated the Chinese belief that the Qing ruler was the master of the globe. This was a marked contrast to the British, who so despised the Chinese sense of superiority that they forced the Chinese to agree to ban the use of the word barbarian in their internal documents. Burlingame believed that the United States was within its rights to demand that the Qing court guarantee the safety of all Americans in China, missionaries and merchants alike. But he did not think that the United States should insist that the Qing give Chinese Christians, for example, similar protection. The Chinese court could treat foreigners one way, he argued, and treat Chinese another. Unfortunately, approaches like Burlingame's led the Chinese government to believe that it was different and that it could bend the rules of international discourse. Bolstering China's ego won Burlingame friends in Beijing, but it would also tempt Chinese officials to capitalize on their theoretical uniqueness to demand special treatment. In November 1867, a Qing official meeting with Burlingame tossed out an idea. Perhaps the American minister could represent China overseas. The Qing court was worried that Western powers wanted to renegotiate the various treaties of Tianjin and further extend their sway. Prince Gong argued that if China were compelled to make more concessions, an anti-foreign backlash would bury all possibility of reform. Only Burlingame could persuade the powers to modify their demands. In a telegram to Secretary of State Seward on November 21st, Burlingame resigned as U.S. Minister to China and, in the interests of my country and civilization, accepted a job as a minister plenipotentiary on the first major Chinese delegation to the West. When the oldest nation in the world seeks to open relations with the West and requests the youngest nation to be its intermediary, Burlingame wrote, "The mission is not one to be rejected." Opposition to the mission came from both China and the United States. Warren, the emperor's tutor, argued that including an American barbarian in a Chinese delegation is tantamount to ignoring the dignity of the empire. Democratic Party-leaning newspapers in America blasted Burlingame, a Republican, for selling his soul to the Chinese. As the steamer carrying the delegation of 30 approached San Francisco in April 1868, Burlingame fretted that his arrival would be marred by protests. But the crowd at San Francisco's wharf had come to cheer. The circus-like reception was just the beginning of a coast-to-coast party for calm Minister Pu and his team. Wearied by the stress of Reconstruction and the impeachment of President Andrew Johnson, America was ready for a distraction. In Boston, the delegation was met by a marching band, 16 two-horse carriages, and 400 mounted troops with swords raised. For 3 hours, the parade snaked through the city. The Stars and Stripes and the Qing Dynasty's triangular yellow streamer festooned the path. The next day, more than 5,000 Bostonians turned out to greet the Chinese. The poet Dr. Oliver Wendell Holmes wrote verse for the occasion, inspired by the vision of a lucrative merger of East and West. "Open wide, ye gates of gold, to the dragon's banner fold. Builders of the mighty wall, bid your mountain barriers fall, so may the girdle of the sun bind the East and West in one." At the welcome banquet at the St. James Hotel on August 21st, the idea of this kind of mingling intrigued another American who rose to speak. In 1868, the transcendentalist philosopher Ralph Waldo Emerson was already 65 years old. American thinkers like him and Henry David Thoreau had begun to mix an element of Asian philosophy into the rich soil of American spirituality. Emerson had been inspired by Confucius's insistence that mankind could achieve perfection through self-cultivation, and his belief that great men could change the world. The sage of Concord was so enamored of the sage of Chufu that he labeled him one of the world's 13 great thinkers, a member of the high priesthood of pure reason. That night at the St. James, Emerson titled his speech, "The Union of the Farthest East and the Farthest West." He noted China's early inventions, such as gunpowder and the printing press, and lavished praise on the Chinese as a people. His talk was so compelling that reporters pressed the elderly American philosopher to stay until 1 a.m., writing out his remarks. In Washington, Burlingame's first stop was Seward's home, where the two men, minus the Chinese, and in defiance of Qing court orders that no treaties were to be negotiated, began hammering out a revised treaty between the United States and China. The idea that two Americans could rewrite an accord between Washington and Beijing did not strike either as bizarre. Americans had already developed a conviction that they knew China's interests better than the Chinese did. The pair discussed whether President Johnson should meet with the Chinese delegation. The issue was reciprocity. Burlingame had never had an audience with the emperor. Nonetheless, on June 6, 1868, the mission went to the White House and found the typically diffident president in a chatty mood. Johnson compared the arduous early years of the American Republic with the Qing Empire's current plight. The merriment continued with a state dinner, a military tribute, a private visit to Seward's home, and a reception thrown by General Ulysses S. Grant, the Republican presidential nominee. In New York City on June 23rd, the delegation was treated to a banquet at Delmonico's at the corner of 14th Street and 5th Avenue, attended by America's leading capitalists and thinkers. At the close of the dinner, Burlingame rose to speak. Before he had arrived in China, Burlingame declared, the West's view of China had been that you must take them by the throat. But thanks to his efforts, he said, trade was up, the Chinese had embraced Western education, Christian missions were growing, the number of steamboats had multiplied, and a railroad had been started. There is no spot on earth where there has been greater progress made within the past few years than in the Empire of China, he claimed. What should the West, and America in particular, do to encourage more change? Let her develop herself in her own time and in her own way, he pleaded. If America just followed this course, he promised untold riches. Let her alone, and that silver which has been flowing for hundreds of years into China will come out into the affairs of men. Although he was well aware of the contents of the record, Burlingame even claimed that China was prepared to invite Protestant missionaries to plant the shining cross on every hill and in every valley. Burlingame's speech, reprinted in newspapers and journals nationwide, touched off a new wave of optimism about China. W.A.P. Martin, who just a few years earlier had urged the United States to recognize the Taiping rebels, now lauded the reforms the Qing had launched. Writing in the New Englander and Yale Review magazine in January 1869, he described a renaissance in China, during which the Chinese mind will be brought proportionally nearer to our own. Others depicted China as an America in waiting. In the November 1868 edition of Harper's, William Spear, another American missionary, described China as one of the freest and most naturally democratic nations in the world. Soon, he predicted, China would resemble, of all places, New England, its pagodas and temples replaced by the white spires of Christian churches and schools. Businessmen were equally buoyant. American firms, pundits wrote, would soon dominate China's river trade, build its telegraph and railroad lines, and dig its mines. There were, of course, skeptics. Burlingame's harshest critic was his successor as U.S. Minister to China, John Ross Brown, a leading 19th-century muckraking reporter who argued that Burlingame had sold the U.S. public a bill of goods. China was not ready to change, he said in a missive to the State Department. He described Burlingame's claims as a hallucination. The Chinese hated all foreigners, he said, Americans included. Brown and Burlingame represented two distinct American views of the Chinese. Burlingame was spellbound by China's potential and argued that the only way forward was to nudge it gently. The term of art would later become manage China's rise toward an outcome beneficial to the United States. Brown was obsessed with China's present and contended that the Qing court needed to be forced to abide by international norms. U.S. policymakers have bounced between forbearance and impatience ever since. Returning to Washington, Burlingame sealed a new treaty with Seward without authorization from the Qing court. The accord, formally titled Additional Articles to the Treaty Between the United States and the Ta Qing Empire of the 18th of June, 1858, but known as the Burlingame Treaty, was revolutionary for the time. It outlawed American ships from transporting Chinese slave labor to South America. It banned discrimination against Chinese workers in America and opened the way for Chinese immigrants to become American citizens. Article 7 promised that Chinese would be welcome at any educational institution under U.S. government control, marking the start of what became the richest intellectual exchange in the modern world. The Burlingame Treaty was just one of a series of steps that Secretary of State Seward took toward Asia. Even before the Civil War had ended, he had gotten Congress to...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.